You probably know this one by the beginning. It's got a beginning where you go, oh yeah, I know that one. Goes like this.
Know that one. It's Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in KISS podcasting. Welcome to the show. It's your buddy Andy, and as always, I'm joined by Nick and by Chris. Hey guys, what's happening?
What's popping?
Oh, you know. Big weekend. Went to a bunch of shows. Went to Riot Fest last week.
Oh, yeah. How was it?
It was fun. I had a good time. Saw the Misfits, the original Misfits reunion.
Were you even relatively close to the stage? I saw our boys, Kelly and Dave, were pretty far away.
I might be closer to the stage now than I was then when I was actually at the venue. That's how far away I was.
Jeez. I didn't know that area was that big.
Is it a full, I believe it was 40,000. I mean, it was totally full, and we were pretty far in the back by the time we got up there. But, yeah, it was something. I saw a couple others. Oh, there's something I wanted to talk to Chris about. I thought he would enjoy. I saw the Buzzcocks on Thursday. And
yeah.
It's funny because this is their 40th anniversary tour.
Right,
some old dudes, you know? And there was a funny mix of people. It was like people who are probably the age of the Buzzcocks and people who are the age of them when they started. And it was like worlds colliding because it was these people who, you know, they were punks in the 70s, but now they're like, you know, professionals. So you see like the overweight, like dentist looking guy with his Nevermind the Bullocks t-shirt tucked into his Hagar slacks. Yeah, exactly. Dad jeans
are pleated slacks.
Which I don't know. I'm not just making fun of the guy. I don't necessarily have a problem with that. But what was funny to watch was that.
Well, you should have a problem with that, for one thing. You shouldn't leave the house looking like that, but whatever.
True enough. But the thing that made it pretty entertaining to watch was watching like these older people standing there, you know, watching the show, and then people in their 20s like having a mosh pit. But it wasn't, you know, it wasn't like a hardcore 80s hardcore mosh pit. It was like a pogo pit, you know? Just people bouncing up and down,
sure,
bumping into each other.
Getting into it.
Gobbing and pogoing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Which is what you do at a punk show,
and
right?
It's, you know, I'm assuming you mean vertical movement.
Yeah, vertical
movement.
So
it's not like a fucking tornado pit where everybody's getting drawn into it.
No, it was vertical movement, but there's the occasional bump into people around
who aren't in it. But not like, is that what they call it, a tornado pit, or is it like a
circle pit?
That's it. You know, that's like horizontal movement.
Yeah.
So, yeah, okay.
But you would not believe the outrage on the face of the older people when these people in their 20s were bumping into them. It was like turn around with wide eyes staring, like concert's ruined. I'm not watching the show anymore. I'm waiting for this guy to come back so I can shove him as hard as I can. It's like, come on, did you forget
fuck you.
Why you're there?
First of all, again, not only should they have not left the house looking like they did, they shouldn't have left the house, period.
Right.
Okay? I'm sure you saw a fair amount of the same type of character as at Riot Fest.
Yeah, but there was a difference there. At Riot Fest, it seemed like the people who were, you know, of advanced years knew to get on the sides or in the back. At this place, it was at the Vic Theater, which is pretty small, and it's like, hey, you know, we want to get right up front, 40th anniversary. It's like, well, if you're going to get up front, people are going to bump into you.
Exactly.
It's a punk show. Even though there are old dudes in the band, it's still a punk show.
Of course.
The same music that it always was, you know?
Is the Vic the one where upstairs there's like theater seating?
Yeah,
go up there.
That's where I was.
I was in still my early 30s the last time I was there.
Yeah.
And last two times I was there, just, okay, where's a seat?
Right.
Yeah, I need a chair, man.
Yeah, it's great if you can sit up there. If you can find a spot, it's like sitting in a movie theater and you get to watch a show.
Yeah, it was perfect. We're like second row,
nothing,
right up.
Nothing to prove as far as being on the floor these days.
No, but.
Oh, fuck no.
There's not a good idea.
And the other thing, there was plenty of space to come up there. If you were an older person, you were like, oh, I didn't realize I was going to get bumped into. Go upstairs and sit down. don't get mad and then try to like take shots at people.
That's a joke.
Like,
that's ridiculous.
These are just kids having fun, exactly. And then you're getting all pissed off trying to fight. You know, it's like what's wrong with you?
People, and I'm sure, my guess is those guys are closer to my age than your guys' age. So they're like maybe pushing 50. It's like, I'm telling you, and I'm guilty of this too, obviously. Anybody who's heard me talk for 2 seconds on the show knows that I'm in a state of arrested development emotionally. But just in general, like 50-year-old people taking selfies and Snapchats and all this shit on social media and, you know, going to Buzzcock shows on a school night, you know. It's like, get with it, you know. Figure it out. You know, if it's too much for you, stay at home.
Right.
I mean, quit acting like a kid if you're not prepared to go all the way with it.
There's a couple shows coming up in the Chicagoland that I would like to go to, and they're not even like punk shows or anything where there's any danger of a pit opening up or, you know. And I'm still just like, I don't know if I can do this.
Really?
Which ones are those? You know, divulge it.
Sure. No, I don't.
Nick doesn't want to be bothered by listeners confronting him.
Buying me tickets. Coming to pick me up. Right. There's the Letters to Cleo is reunited and coming around.
Okay.
One of my favorites.
Where are they playing?
I forget. If theirs is something like the Vic or House of Blues or Metro. I forget, but
like a 1500
something,
whatever,
like that.
1,000
feet. Yeah, I forget exactly where, either way.
Right.
And then at the Park West, the Proclaimers are going to be there, and they're like never in America.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm a fan of a few of their albums. So.
Well, I know this is one of Nick's favorite phrases, so I'm going to use it. But I've got a life hack for you.
Oh, great.
One time I went to a show at Park West, and the guy I was with had a cane. Do that. Just pretend there's something wrong with you. They'll give you a nice round leather booth to sit in. Come give you table service. No extra charge.
Really nice venue, yeah. But it's just going there. I don't know if I can do that.
Yeah,
just
House of Blues is like a deal breaker for me because unless you pay the big bucks to get in one of those like balconies,
the
little restaurant,
you
got to
stand
area.
Up, and I just can't do it anymore.
Right.
It's just not in the game plan for me.
There was a guy, I don't know, probably only Chicago people would recognize him, but Hot Doug from Hot Doug's.
He was at the Buzzcocks?
Going apeshit the whole time in one of the balconies.
Yeah?
Yeah, singing every word. That's like the weird artisan sausage. It's like bizarre animal meat or whatever. I don't even know, but yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of famous thing, like alligator.
Now, who
hot dog
pointed that out to you? Or
I
did
just,
you recognize
I don't know why. I looked over, I'm like, that guy looks so familiar.
Andy knows like the famous fans. Like, when we were at wrestling, he pointed out a famous fan.
Hey, I don't know how.
I'm like, how do you know?
I think I just remember faces of people I've seen more than anything.
Okay.
But yeah, I was like, who's that guy? I was like, oh shit, that's Hot Dog. My wife's like, how do you know that? Why would you even know? It's just a normal guy. I'm like, let's look it up. It was Hot Dog. So
you looked it up, huh? Did you cue in the theme music
what did you do on your phone?
Yeah, I was like, hold on. Before we go on Google.
Then you just compared his face to the picture.
Yeah. You know, obviously him. 1 second.
Yeah,
perfect recognition.
I think at all the shows I've been to, I saw one famous person in the crowd at a show. Went to see Anthrax when they got back together. I think it was the first tour when they got Joey back to, you know,
okay.
Vocals.
Sure.
I can never say his name right, but comedian, really tall guy, Brian was it Posehn?
Oh,
yeah,
Posehn.
Yeah,
Posehn, yeah. Yeah, and I mean, that guy stuck out like a sore thumb because he's just a very big guy. Yeah. Yeah, probably the only noteworthy person I've ever seen.
Didn't you see Charlie from Anthrax at a concert?
I saw him outside of the United Center getting VIP tickets for a Pearl Jam. Mm. It was a Descendants. Bad Religion opening.
For Pearl Jam?
For Pearl Jam, that show.
Really?
Yeah.
That could be fun.
I think it was Bad Religion's 25th or something like that.
Wow.
And saw Charlie. Nobody was talking to him, and I'm like, I'm not going to be that guy.
Let him slide.
I have nothing to say. You know, I'm just, what am I going to say he hasn't heard a zillion times already?
Yeah.
So.
So today's theme is bands who opened for Pearl Jam, apparently. I think Buzzcocks were on a tour with them, too, at one point. Last 10 years or so.
There you go.
Hmm. Well, I don't know how that's going to lead into this week's song, but maybe, you know, sometimes we foresee the future in our discussion. It's like speaking of letters to Cleo, it's like a Miss Cleo kind of situation.
She died recently, didn't she?
Hmm.
I'm sure she expected it. So
I'm watching.
See what I did there.
I couldn't have been a surprise. That's good.
I'm looking at Andy searching for Eclipse. I think I know which one he wants to go to.
I was gonna be a bad person, and then I decided not to. So there you go.
You should never censor yourself in that way,
especially when it comes to Miss Cleo.
Yeah, I can't support that.
Mm, well, I apologize. All right,
I see the internal battle. It's coming through. Andy's like, do I go for the sound clip that everybody, well, maybe not everybody, but some people are expecting?
It's the proverbial angel and devil on his shoulder.
Exactly. Yeah,
it's interesting to watch right now.
Yeah. Well, not doing it.
Oh, well,
so
it's over.
And then, much like in Animal House, the angel won out, to which the devil said to the guy, "You homo." So I'm saying the same thing to you.
All right. Fair enough. How about this?
Yeah, I'd pulled a boner.
Okay.
There you go.
There you go. Didn't think I'd hear that one ever again.
You never know. Once in a while, all these old clips come back. They resurface over time.
Speaking of old, the random song generator as far as last episode, still working, but
yeah,
you know, it's always a crapshoot with this thing.
When the weather's about to break, I think, into fall here.
Of course, some people, myself included, might question that it's working right at all because of the lack of Dynasty cuts that just remains to be a complete mystery on this show.
Wait a minute!
I'm making that accusation. I mean, I don't know what else to say. What is this, 174?
Yeah.
And we have had one fucking Dynasty cut.
That's pretty crazy, huh?
I don't know what to say about that. Mm.
It's the one I would have picked if I had the chance, so I'm happy.
So you're good?
I'm good.
We're done. We
pack
don't even
up
need it.
Pack up Dynasty. We don't need it anymore.
You heard it.
Really?
No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, please.
there's one that I am absolutely, there's a song on there I adore that we haven't done yet. So.
That's real funny.
If you don't adore Dirty Livin', then it could be any of them because we haven't done any from.
Well, I mean, album. Dirty Livin', that's a favorite.
Oh, sure.
As well,
oh, sure.
So.
Absolutely, but that's been the only one. If you're new to this program, songs get picked at random. Every Kiss studio cut is in the hopper, and we've had one tune from Dynasty in 173 episodes.
We've almost closed out other albums. I don't think we've officially closed anything out yet.
We're close on Unmasked and Gene's solo album.
Lick It Up is almost done.
Yeah, we're very close on a couple, but
yeah.
You know, it's been a nice spread of
a
little bit from here, a little bit there, and not much from Dynasty at all. So,
it's not much. It's one fucking
right,
song.
Exactly.
I need to just
putting it mildly.
Keep harping on that. So anyway, back to the random song generator. It's time to boot it up, Nick.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we're getting some pretty nice end of summer, early fall weather. So I'm expecting it should be okay. The winter coming. We're supposed to have a bad cold winter.
We might have to.
The old farmer's almanac says so.
Right. That's the other thing.
Don't get Andy
started. I'm so tired of hearing people talking about the weather. Because here's what happens. People talk about, it's going to be a brutal winter. It's going to be terrible. It's going to be the worst one we've had in years. And then whether it happens or doesn't happen, nobody ever goes, it doesn't go back to that. So it was like fake news. Everyone's talking about it. When you make small talk with people you don't really talk too much, that's always the subject. Yeah, winter's going to be bad this year. Oh, yeah, getting ready. And then it's just fine. It's it's mild, average winter.
It's bullshit.
It's just
total crap.
Yeah.
That said, though, if it should come to pass, we might have to do like what they do up in Canada, get one of those engine block heaters that you have to actually attach to your car to get the fucking thing to start in the morning.
Right, right.
So, you know, we got to get to the end of this podcast, and without the song generator, I mean, what are we going to do?
I don't know.
I shouldn't be predicting doom and gloom. It's been working. Functioning, powering up in terms of putting out songs in a reasonable manner. It has not been doing that, but what are you going to do?
I'm expecting no problems today. It is nice out. Good operating temperature for this piece of equipment. I was looking through the specs for most of the interfaces that we've added on.
Right.
It's right in the middle of the operating temperature, acceptable operating temperature.
You got your AutoZone diagnostics kit.
Got all kinds of test equipment here.
All right.
So
it's booted up. See if it powers.
We're just
going to
turn it on, see if it works.
Oh, yeah.
All right, sure.
Okay, that's good.
Might need those lasers to defrost some cars
in
a couple months.
So as has been the ritual for recent episodes, that's only half of the equation. The other half is we need the delivery of the item. Nick doesn't lower himself to bringing the piece of exclusive merchandise himself. He has it delivered now, which I love.
It compromises some of the MIB items that I have.
What's that? What's MIB?
Isn't that mint in box or mint in package?
Oh, okay.
Like his eBay listing lingo.
Not my Will Smith
Tommy
Lee Jones figures.
What's the one that you said? Wow. That's the best when you look at an eBay listing. Wow.
But I love that because you're kind of a big shot in the podcast world, so you should have shit delivered to you, things done for you.
Well, and
I wholeheartedly support that.
Dish out cash to get this double platinum package that I'm part of with the room service merchandise delivery service, that's what I'm doing. I'm not taking any chances. It's the weekend right now. I'm paying like a weekend. It's covered. It's like, what, Amazon Prime or Amazon whatever.
Yeah.
You're covered, you know. But you have to dish out that important cash for that double platinum package.
Mm. Yeah, but again, like I said, you're a big shot now. This is chump change for you.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, wipe your ass with this amount of money on a daily basis.
Like, I'm not going to go sweep a KB toy store in the clearance section trying to find an old figure or something.
No, those days are over.
That's for just derelicts at this point.
Right.
That's for the next Kiss podcast. Which, actually, I was wondering about that. Are we still bringing up the rear in that, or have other Kiss podcasts surfaced since we started? Because we were like the Johnny come late.
I think we're still the noobs.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's like all of the other like 12 Kiss podcasts were established, and here come us three assholes. Barreling onto the scene.
We didn't know any better.
And we're pretty much like none of have happened since. So.
Yeah, I almost feel like we should have asked somebody if it was okay.
Yeah.
Everyone turned their back on us.
We just kind of brashly,
You guys weren't invited here.
Crash the party, you know?
Well, that's kind of that's the beauty of podcasting or the whole internet is like, you don't have to wait for permission. Just fucking step out and do it. So, you think you're delivering? How do you know the delivery guy's on the way?
Let me peek out the window.
A push notification of some sort.
Let me peek out the window. I do get those, yes, but I like to go the old-fashioned way and see if anybody's coming.
And this is a service like a Dollar Shave Club or whatever, where every week somehow it's always when we record.
Well, that's
the random item shows up.
That's part of the double platinum package.
Okay.
I let them know.
Double platinum package. I love that.
I let them know. They put a little. They do some extended soloing and some disco beats for me.
Mm.
Double platinum.
I gotcha.
Yeah, there. Mm-hmm. And they. It's like we were saying the other week, where you pay them, they accommodate. It's all about convenience. It's a culture of convenience, and in Kiss collecting, there's no point in having any sort of struggle. So there you go.
And it's just Kiss items, right? Can you not get household items?
No, it's this is purely like Kiss related.
Toilet paper 78 from the double platinum package.
I mean that. Oh yeah, that could certainly happen. So
all right, well, so what do we do? Just sit here and wait?
Well, I think let me go check the
mailman's got to show up, and then that piece of merchandise. Then
normally
interacts.
We have this timed up pretty well, right?
Yeah, I don't know.
It
is Saturday, like Nick said.
I'm
going to
check out the window again. And for those at home listening, I am actually standing up and looking out the window. Mm. You know, I'm just to kind of save my strength, I'm just going to sit down and I'm just going to wait. I hope that's not too boring for the listeners, but, you know.
Watched kettle never boils. What's that saying?
Yeah.
That sounds right. Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah!
There's the mailman.
A rather boisterous mailman. Today.
Wait a minute. Look who it is.
I got some mail for the wild people over here. Oh, yeah. Ow!
This is the greatest mailman we've ever had.
How you doing, people?
Jeez.
Oh, yeah.
You're louder than Andy on the intro. Lately.
I got a little mail over here.
Wow. Could you hand it over to...
Looking for someone named Nick. Is that you over
there? That'd be me. Here's your dime.
Is that you knocking at my door? Oh, yeah.
There you go.
All right.
It's really not Paul Stanley, guys.
No.
No, it's not. It's not. Sorry, I thought you thought it was, but it's not. It's really me.
This week's guest mailman.
None
other than Chris Jericho. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. I'm really excited excited to deliver the mail. It's always the number one most important thing, rain or sleet or snow.
That's right.
You deliver the mail. And it was hard to find. You're at the Embassy Suites. You didn't tell me what room that you're in. So I went and knocked on about 422 doors. But I found you to deliver the bounty to you guys.
Just follow the smell. lead you to us.
Cooking some potpourri in here or something. I'm not sure what it
cooking
is.
Cooking something.
But I'm really excited to be here on the Pot of Thunder, man.
Oh, we're
welcome.
Excited to have you. This is a big deal.
It's pretty monumental. Am I your first guest you've ever
had? Yes, I was just about to say, we're horning in on the formula of other KISS podcasts to have, like, D-list celebrities in, and so you're our first
one.
I'm
the first one.
Yeah.
I'm but more of a D-minus. I'm more of an E-plus celebrity.
Well,
we'll
see how you do.
That could be better.
We'll throw you out
nervous,
if you're not
man.
Up to standard.
I'm nervous. I don't really spend a lot of time with a microphone, so I don't know exactly what to do.
Right, yeah.
But I'll try my best. I will say this, though. Last night, this is what I do a lot of times when if I'm at home, my wife and kids go to bed. I always watch the exact same thing if I'm having a couple drinks. I go watch all of the 80s KISS videos in chronological order, but they have to be non-makeup. And I always start with Sure Know Something just because it's fun. And then I go start with Lick It Up and go all the way through to I Just Wanna.
There you go.
And I did that last night. It takes about 2 hours.
Interesting.
But, so I'm a little bit tired today, a little bit hungover. But I got to see some great 80s KISS videos, which are always awesome.
You just pull them up online?
Yeah.
Go right through them? Yeah.
Go through them in order on YouTube.
That's great. That's a great ritual to have.
It's fun. You know, you get to see them. They're all really good. Like, obviously. And then if I'm really, really awake, then I'll watch Live Uncensored Animalized Tour.
Yes. Sure.
Wow.
But I mean, it's fun to watch. Like, you know, I know a lot of people might cut down 80s KISS, but the hooks, the melodies, the singing. I mean, they were awesome, man. They've been great. They were great.
Well, and the merchandise has an 80s KISS slant to it,
sure
yes.
Does.
So, as we've...
an image from 82 on it.
As we've demonstrated on this podcast, there's occasionally some foreshadowing. So who knows what's at work?
I just
here.
Love actually looking at you guys while you're talking because I just hear your voices. And before I met you, I had no idea what anybody looked like. So I had you envision people when you see them, when you hear them. And then when you see them, and none of you guys looked like I thought you would. Actually, Chris kind of did.
Chris.
Well, kind of a smarmy, sarcastic, kind of strange man.
Assholes tend to have a similar look, you know. You can spot them a mile away.
You totally
but
could
these other two are.
Yeah, those are the nice guys and the asshole.
Yep. Well, you know.
There you go.
That's pretty much the dynamic. Now we got two assholes
that's
in here.
Exactly,
so we're
right.
We've balanced
it's
it.
Like Cheap Trick now.
Yeah, exactly. Right, exactly.
Except for instead of two hot guys, two ugly guys, it's two nice guys and two assholes.
Me and Andy will be on the front cover.
Yes, that's right.
Exactly.
Me and Chris will be in the back.
Exactly
Chris,
right.
You're Bunny Carlos just by proxy.
All right.
So what do you got?
I've got something. It's an Eric Carr. It's a set of Eric Carr cufflinks.
Mm.
And it's got the little image on it, which is... If I'm going to go with an image personally, this is the one I would go with. It's from the Creatures album cover.
Mm-hmm.
Got that little blue tint to
it. Nice.
Cool. Cool.
A little light up, you know, white eyes. And it looks like a couple of almost trading cards inside of there.
There's a guitar pick, too.
There's a guitar pick.
I just love the fact they exist. There's Eric Carr cufflinks. I like that.
You might need them.
It's got it's got some facts, Eric Carr facts on the back.
Tell us the best
cards.
Fact on there.
Okay. Yeah, I'm a factoid.
Give me a fact about Eric Carr.
Before settling on his final stage name, Eric was considering renaming himself Rusty Blade.
Oh, no way Gene would have went for that.
He would later use this name as an alias while on tour.
Okay, Gene,
Rusty Blade.
Gene never would allow that. He never would allow that.
No way.
Didn't remember he wanted George Lynch to change his name to John Lynx? Did you guys ever hear that?
I don't think I've ever heard that.
George Lynch was in the running to be in Kiss?
No, but when he was in the messing around with Van Halen like in 78 and 79, he used to see George Lynch's band and said that George Lynch is a dumb name. You'd be called John Lynx.
Why is that better? No, it's like kind of a lateral name change.
I agree.
It's not worse. It's not better. It's just
the
like
same.
Situations you hear of like that, you wonder, is there a conversation happening beforehand where that comes out? Or does he's like, I'm Gene Simmons. I'm established. I'm going to walk up to this guy and tell him, I think your name should be this.
I think you know the answer.
I'm going to give him the sage advice.
I think we know the answer. I think Gene just walked up to him unannounced and unasked and just went, hey. You need to change your name.
It's just like a power play. I'm going to put my stamp on you.
Sounds like Prince did that a lot, right?
I'm Gene Simmons from the rock group Kiss. That was my first ever attempt at a Gene Simmons.
That was
Simmons,
great.
So
good.
Wasn't
you're much you're
better
nailing
than,
it.
Much better than any of us.
Two for two now, man.
Yeah.
Nailing it.
Two, well, three, four, five. We got to get every member. Can you do a Tommy Thayer? We'll give you time to work on it.
Well, it's kind of really quiet.
Oh, okay.
Doesn't say a lot. Smiles. He's got a really big head, too.
He does. Yeah. He has a defined jaw, doesn't he?
Yeah, he has a very square jaw.
And not egotistical big head, like a literal big, big cranium. Yeah. Nice guy, though. Yeah.
Quick side note. Player. One time I met Hillary Clinton.
Ooh.
Enormous head.
Really?
I couldn't believe my eyes how big her head was. I'm like, that must be part of the power that this woman has.
Let me ask you a question.
Huge head.
Do we think Hillary's going to make it to the election, or is she going to die of this strange illness that she seems to have?
That's kind of the thing that's going on now. Everyone's saying she's passing out, her shoe fell off, and they're carrying her into the limo.
She can't stop. If you go online, you can see all the conspiracy theories that she coughs a lot.
Yeah.
Have you seen this video?
No.
I have, yeah.
Not.
You can go online and look up Hillary Clinton coughing. So, you know, June 2016, exactly. Hillary Clinton coughed 15 times in a public appearance.
Yeah. Right.
And you watch it, it's like, wow, maybe she has, like, you know, tongue issues or something.
Yeah, there might be something
going
on.
I don't want to say the word because I don't want to put that out in the universe.
Understandable.
But, you know, let's just say that.
Issues.
A little issues. She
might have contracted AIDS from Bill. I mean, stick
that's
his
right.
dick
you don't
in anything.
You don't have to cover anything on this show. You no, say what you want, say what you feel.
Yeah. Nobody cares. Right, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, okay. We get that shit enough at our day jobs.
Right.
It's your chance
told
to fly,
what to do.
Man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Shit. Right.
Fuck, so how do the cufflinks get a song out of the generator?
Well, I noticed that the cufflinks look like they're possibly made out of some sort of precious metal.
Mm.
And I've been looking to replace some some resistors inside of some of the circuitry in the random song generator.
Wow, so these are going to be recycled?
These are going to be recycled just kind of for now, just for this process of choosing the song and then, you know.
You're not going to damage the cufflinks.
Well, I mean, I don't know how much voltage is going to get through it. I don't know what the resistance rating is on these things, but I'm gonna replace them real quick.
It's always a crapshoot.
Is that thing still on? I know we fired it up earlier.
Yeah,
it's machine.
Yeah, it's still running. I mean, unless you want me to do a little check on it.
You might as well turn it back.
Normally, we don't sit here and talk to the mailman for this length of time.
Well, and usually he's gone, but I'm not leaving. I'm sitting in on the session. So there you go. Right. I'm like Yoko Ono. You can't make me leave.
You're just going to scream in the background while we're...
You might want to get up and leave if we get a Peter Criss solo cut out of this thing.
See, that would be the worst. I've been listening to your guys' show. I've heard probably 80%. The only ones I haven't listened to are songs I just don't really care for.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be the shits if we get like one that I don't really care for. I'd have to sit here for an hour and talk to you losers about something I don't even care
about.
Yeah,
you're just going
to
be looking at your phone.
You matter
nobody
to me.
Wants that. Yeah, I don't know what kind of discussion we would have. That's one to get you fired up for a wrestling match.
You matter to
it?
Me. Yeah. That's probably I think it's the only one I actually know on that album too. Besides yeah.
That's
kind of
Sugar Papa Likes. Even if you don't know it, you got to know the name.
But I knew this name. Yeah. Actually, I think I know that song as well. I don't have the Peter Criss solo album, nor do I have the Gene Simmons. I got to be honest with you guys. I never bought those two.
Yeah, between you, me, and everyone else. If you're wrong.
But I'm a huge Ace and Paul solo album guys.
Those are essential.
Paul's is the best, in my opinion.
I think I'm with you, Chris.
You know, I'm actually coming around to that. I had the Ace and the Peter. Because they were my favorite members of the band. But thanks to this podcast, delving into the Paul, I mean, he just spills it out there.
Quite honestly, I mean, the only song that's not good is the single, Hold Me, Touch Me. I never got into that. But the other eight tunes are all, if they were on any Kiss album, they'd be huge hits. If that was a Kiss album, it would have sold 2 million copies.
I agree with you.
You know, right in that Love Gun era, it would have fit right in with it.
Totally. I think it's a shame they never really play any of those live.
Yeah, I mean, that's why, you know, when Paul did his solo tour in 89 and also in 2006, it was great because you got to hear all those songs, Tonight You Belong to Me and Move On. And
we went to that. Nick and I went to the DVD, the One Live Kiss from 2006. Yeah.
Was that in Chicago?
Yeah, it was at House of Blues in Chicago. Cool. Yeah.
I fucked up. I didn't go. They invited me. I didn't go. I don't know.
I went to the one in L.A. at Hollywood's House of Blues, and Gene and Bruce Kulick were there.
Oh, that's cool.
And I was watching Bruce. They had that guitar player who's just nuts, that Brazilian guy. Just watching Bruce, watching
Rafael Moreira.
Yeah, Rafael. Yeah, man. Yeah. That guy's a great player.
Oh, yeah, wicked.
It was a good show. It was fun. So cool. So what do we do now?
Fire it up,
Nick. I'm going to go fire it up once more. And just
stand
sure
back, Jericho. I'm go up and
put on the goggles.
Yeah, we don't have any kind of insurance here. So
if anybody's going to die here, let it be Nick.
This is going to be like Back to the Future. When you turn it on, it's going to blow me back into the giant amps.
You never know. I mean, it's an artifact from that era.
It is.
All right, well, here I go.
There, it still works. Good.
No problems today.
It went into sleep mode. Never know it's going to wake back up.
When you guys started using that, I was like, I totally know that song. I didn't know the name of it. And you guys said it's from George Michael's Sports Machine. I remember hearing that, and I'll tell you the reason why I always have kind of bad memories, because that was on at 10:30 Sunday night, which was my bedtime when I was like in high school. So whenever I heard that, I knew it was time to go to bed.
You hated it, right?
I hated it, yeah.
Me too. Same thing.
I think it was on right after the Gary Shandling show for some odd reason. Ooh. I used to love that. Okay. And then Sports Machine came on right after, and that was when I, time for bed, Chris. Shit. Yeah. I hate you, George. I hate you, fake George Michael. Yeah.
I also had the same feeling about MASH for a while, because that was another Sunday night show.
Sure.
I like the show now, but at the time it was bedtime, the opening song. It's like, oh, man.
I'll do you one
go
better,
to
too, the Jerry Lewis telethon. Okay. That was always on the day before we had to go back to school.
Yeah,
was it for you guys?
Exactly.
So whenever I saw that, I was like, I love the concept. Yeah. I'm all for the...
summer's over.
Yeah, summer's over. I hate you, Jerry Lewis.
Yeah, when he's up there... crying his eyes out at the end. It's like, yeah, so am I. I got to go to school.
Yeah, I got to go to school. Yeah.
I even have that
we cried together.
I even have that with the Benny Hill show. Like in Chicago in the 80s, for some reason, Benny Hill was on syndication.
The most festive, fun, up-tempo music just depresses you because of the context.
I guess so.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, same thing in the D. Benny Hill was like 11:30. So.
And Winnipeg, too. Benny Hill was nationwide, man. There you go.
We should do a Benny Hill podcast.
Yeah, let's do it.
We could start that in 2 years.
I guarantee seven people would listen to it.
Yeah.
And three of them would be us.
That would be an improvement
of what we have now. That would be, six more people would listen to this
now
podcast.
You guys are going to get huge ratings now that this D-minus listeners on the show.
Are we going to get the Jericho bump?
Yeah, at least 100 people, I think, probably.
That's exciting. Good.
100 Kiss fans.
We'll take what we can get, believe me.
That's not bad, sure. We're going to spread. So this has to be a good show, guys.
Well, it all hinges on this piece
of
shit.
That's right.
You know, maybe a miracle will happen and we'll get a dynasty cut. Who knows?
Ooh.
Anything, except for the 173 songs we've done already. Anything's in play.
You never know.
What was the one that you were waiting for? Was it?
Charisma.
Charisma, right. But there was one that you were waiting for that you actually got already that you were super excited about.
Got Love for
Love
Sale.
Love for Sale, that was it.
Yeah, that was the big, there was a, that's been a point of contention between me and Nick for years.
That's pretty much the genesis
of
Pot of Thunder.
Okay, since you're here, real quick, Got Love for Sale, Hell or Hallelujah?
Hell.
Damn.
Somebody's got sense in this room, finally.
I just found it was one of those kind of generic Gene songs that I wasn't really into, so.
Sorry. Oh.
Sorry, dude.
If we had more time, I'd convince you, just like I did Nick. But
well,
I still
shot it down, but I said there were redeeming qualities.
Yeah, and
the drumming, particularly.
Well, 70s Kiss always has redeeming qualities.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? Maybe if we heard it, it'd be like you listen to some of the tunes that you don't know if you would like. And then when you hear it and analyze it, maybe I would like it too. But just thinking about it off the top of my head, I would say no, but I haven't heard it and dissected it. So
you didn't sit through all three Got Love for Sale episodes.
Yeah, it's one of the ones where I don't really care for the song, yeah. So I didn't listen to
I don't like
them.
The song, nor am I going to listen to three episodes.
Yes,
about
especially,
it.
You know what? I don't like episodes that you're not on, Chris. I got to be honest
with you.
There
you go.
Well, yeah, there was one that was, yeah, right.
It's just, he's kind of like he's the Simon Cowell of the show.
Well, and I don't like episodes that one of us is not, because the one thing, you know, that we will always have that no other podcast has is this ridiculous interpersonal chemistry.
Sure.
Between us.
Friends for life.
Yeah, and, you know, different age groups and, you know, it's just
a good cross section.
Yeah. So, I mean, me personally, I would prefer when one of us can't do an episode, I prefer we take a week off. Okay. But sometimes we just decide to wing it, whatever. Because, again,
can't disappoint.
Hey, man, people are creatures of habit. I was there last Monday or two Mondays ago when you guys were off, and I was almost going to text Adam and say, "Are you guys all right?" I thought maybe something happened. I was scared.
Well, Nick, you know.
Apologize.
Andy, but that's okay. That hurt. That cut me deep.
Who do we know?
But that's okay.
Is Adam handling us?
Yeah. No.
I wasn't talking about you. Oh, okay. Adam Schwartz, the manager of the show.
Oh, okay.
It's funny because
Adam,
you wouldn't believe.
Adam, Mick, and Nathaniel here. Glad to see all you guys.
You wouldn't believe how many times that's happened to me in
really?
My life. It happened to me at work where we were working on name drop. We're working on something for the Late Show last week. I kept getting emails that started with Adam, and I'm like, dude, my name, it says Andy. You're
on
replying to it. Thanks, Adam. I'm like, what's...
See, I was actually reading your email. Actually, I work for the,
okay.
The Late Show.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
For
okay.
The Late Show.
Got it.
All right. All right. Well, let's
I'm doing it. Here I go.
All right.
Pray for me.
This one comes off.
Crazy Nights.
Yes.
It's called
Turn on the Night. Very,
okay.
Very exciting.
I love this song.
You prime the pump, my friend.
I just watched the video for it last night.
Oh.
I can't believe it. That's one of the ones I watched.
There's a video.
See, now this is news to me. Not only have I never heard this song, this is one that I'll be hearing for the first time with you here.
Okay.
And naturally, I would not know if there was a video for it either. Turns out there is.
There
yeah.
is.
Oh,
it was
well,
the
this
third
is
single. For, it's a pop song. I'll be honest with you.
Well, aren't all '80s Kiss songs pop?
This is on the top of the pop list from the '80s. Yeah.
Oh boy. So far, I'm not excited,
yeah,
but I'm excited because Chris Jericho is here and. You know, these new discoveries are, you never know what can happen.
Yeah, that's right. It's a polarizing song, I think. I remember when I first heard it, I was like, well, I don't know if I like it. But I love Crazy Nights, the album, and I don't really know, like, why, because it's not really critically acclaimed in the Kiss pantheon.
Yeah.
But mm-hmm. I think for me, it's an album that came out right before, I think the anniversary of it was 2 or 3 days ago. Mm. I was just starting grade 12, my senior year in high school.
Okay.
So this album was playing in this really cool time of my life. So I always loved this album. Same reason why
go.
I think Seventh Son of a Seventh Son is like my second favorite Iron Maiden record for the same reason. So
and your first favorite?
Power
is?
Slave.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Power Slave,
for sure.
Which is the first I bought. So yeah, all right. Turn on the Night. You got the book there?
We do have the book. You know, I just thumbed through it while you
Can
guys
I see
were
the
chatting.
Cover? I've never seen it before.
You've never seen this book.
I gotta
book,
get
huh?
that.
It's a great book.
Behind the Mask. Okay, cool. Yeah.
It's kind of like, I don't know if it's technically outdated at this point, since how old is it?
Oh, God. I don't know. I think it goes up to Psycho Circus. But, I mean, that's
oh, thanks, man.
Pretty much everything.
Well, you know, how can it be outdated? This is
well, I guess
you mean
so.
In terms of having like monster.
Well,
and
yeah, and yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, whatever.
It's
the
just
commentary
it's
is timeless, and it was captured around the time that the stuff came out. I presume so.
Well, Turn on the Night, Diane Warren. Do we know who Diane Warren is? I don't.
She's
know.
A songwriter.
Didn't she write that
right?
shit for Aerosmith?
Yeah. Shit
poppy
for
stuff?
Aerosmith.
Isn't she written some Aerosmith tunes?
What, like the '90s ones? The
yeah, like
the Alicia Silverstone. Video songs,
yeah, or that ghastly thing from the from Pearl Harbor, whatever that.
Don't want to miss.
Didn't she write "Honkin' on Bobo" the title track?
Yeah,
terrible album title. Awful.
The jokes.
Aerosmith is like the Dexter of hard rock. They've got some of the greatest moments and some of the worst moments in their career.
Agreed.
Yeah. You could. Some people would say that about Kiss as well.
Sure, yeah, for sure, of course, whatever. But they can fuck off.
Okay. Yeah.
So Paul Stanley said, "I'd known Diane before she ever became Diane Warren in capital letters. Laughs."
Yeah, he knew her in a biblical sense, I'm sure.
When I was writing songs for Crazy Nights, I very much wanted to write a song with her. Diane came up with the title, and then we wrote it. She was a very big part of writing that song. So there you go, a Paul Stanley, Diane Warren collaboration.
Okay.
That's definitely going to be a pop song. Yeah, no question about that. Yeah. So this was a single, huh?
It was the third single from Crazy Nights. I actually think I talked to well, talk about name dropping. You guys know that I am friends with some of the guys in the Kiss camp.
Yep.
And I talked
to other D-listers.
Other D-listers like Paul. Yeah. And I said this song, like if Crazy Nights would have gotten a proper push, this could have been like a Living on a Prayer type song that plays today on like classic rock radio. It's that total 80s, you know, metal pop type of stuff but Kiss never really got the break. And he said that they didn't give it really much of a chance shove. Yeah. They never really got much airplay in the 80s.
See, at that point, I mean, I was watching MTV a lot. I was 7, 8 at that point. And I remember the title track, or if you want to call it that, there's two crazies.
Crazy,
whatever.
Crazy.
But I remember loving that video, mostly because Gene shoots like a Roman candle out of the top of his face.
From Turn of the Night?
No, from the actual Crazy Nights
crazy
video.
Nights
and I remember loving that and didn't even realize that there was a video for this until like few years ago, I think. For this song, because it must not have been pushed at all.
It was hardly pushed. Yeah. I think it made like the number 89 on the charts or something like that, one of those things.
Yeah.
But the video is almost exactly the same as Crazy Nights. It's like a live
it's the same
thing.
Same stage, probably.
But actually,
is there some tits and ass?
There is some
video?
Tits and ass. There's a chick who has a giant fuse box and Kiss is playing on the roof of a building.
Really?
And she turns the fuse box on or turns it off. I can't remember. And it's got this.
I think
really
she turns it off.
Off.
But then does that turn on the night when the
Maybe.
Box goes off?
It's
some weird thing.
Kind of electrical yeah. thing. Like.
Yeah.
I see what they did there.
That was okay. Another thing that they used to do a lot in the 80s when they would have a music video and they would add sound effects of what was going on over top of the song.
Yeah.
So you got the.
Yeah.
Well, we had, was it All Hell's Breaking Loose, where they punch the guy in the beginning.
And that bottle breaks.
The bottle
worst bottle sound ever. He throws like a whiskey bottle at the ground. It sounds like the world's like an airplane bottle shatters.
Yes.
It's terrible.
Actually, I've actually just Wikipedia'd the song. And maybe
look at you.
You looked it up.
You're horning in on Andy's territory.
Maybe I can give you guys a couple
Andy, you're fired.
Tidbits about this song.
Wait a minute. So you looked something up on your phone? Is that what you did?
Yeah.
Is that what
right, well.
Is that what happened here?
Sorry, wow. We have to.
All right, so of course you do. I wouldn't want to miss out on that. Turn on the Night was the third single off the album. A music video was made in Worcester, Massachusetts on January 27th, 1988.
Wow, Worcester, Massachusetts.
Yeah, directed by Marty Callner, very famous director of the time. Turn on the Night only charted in the UK, where it reached number 41. So there you go. And it was backed with Hell or High Water was the B-side of that.
That's right.
Which I own the 45, thanks to Andy.
Really?
He got it for me, a throwback Christmas present a few years ago. So
only good Christmas present I've ever given.
Nice. Yeah. So only charted in the UK. Crazy Nights was a big album in the UK, wasn't it?
It's interesting.
People love
that. That's like, I mean, we've had a lot of Unmasked. I mean, that was big in Australia. It's like, I guess. Yeah.
But I mean, Crazy Nights was number 4 in the UK charts. Reason to Live 33 and Turn of the Night 41. So that's 3 top 40 singles, basically.
There you go.
From Crazy Nights.
That surprises me.
Yeah,
our Chris is outraged.
Yes.
Not outraged. I'm surprised. It's like, it just. Kiss in Britain is kind of a weird,
strange. Yeah, I agree.
Mind warp for
you
me.
You would have back then. You would have heard the British equivalent of a Casey Kasem introing this song, doing a dedication perhaps before it.
Yeah.
Yes, Chris is not really too British in his attitude or demeanor.
No, I'm not. No. No.
Yeah. Actually, I work with a couple British guys, and it's not far off from
they're just
really?
This crotchety.
It seems like. curmudgeon-y. Not really sarcasm, but the dry put down attitude seems to be prevalent with at least the guys that I've met.
I can get that.
Yeah, it's just the Ponzi accent that you can't
the
get
Ponzi
on board
accent.
With.
Ponzi accent.
I bet you Vinnie nice. Ponzi was English. With an Italian Englishman, maybe.
Also, since there is a video, as people know, we, instead of simply listening to the song, we will be watching the video and analyzing that as well.
But here's something I don't like when you guys do this as an outsider.
Ooh.
Oh, boy.
You guys
no
analyze
good.
The video
too
more
much?
Than you analyze the song sometimes.
We do do apologize usually for that.
I'll
yeah.
be the voice of reason that keeps the eye on the song
okay.
As we're watching the video as well.
Okay. Contrary to popular belief, we are not perfect. So thanks for the criticism.
I think you personally are.
Thank God you showed up.
Yeah, jeez. Yeah,
otherwise, we'd be talking about this stupid fucking video all
day. Only 170 70 shows gone by, and now you finally get someone to figure it out.
Yeah, you know, it's a learning process.
Do you guys realize you're still going to be doing this for like another year and a half?
Like 2 years.
Is it 2 years?
It's almost
and
2 years.
And there's talk of a new album.
That must make
stuff
you guys
reading.
Is Samurai Sun on the list?
It's got to be in there.
It's got to be in there. I think it's official.
It's an official release.
Official release. Yeah, I bought it on iTunes. It's
there you go.
Official
yeah.
release.
So there you go.
The Ascot song from the Scooby-Doo movie does not count.
The
Scooby.
Ascot?
Yeah. What was that called?
Don't touch my Ascot.
Or,
that's not an official.
That doesn't
release.
Count.
That's
but
just
okay.
That's
good.
A
you heard it here first.
That doesn't count.
I read online somebody was saying, can you believe it that if Kiss doesn't come out with another album, Don't Touch My Ascot might be their last official recording.
That's fine.
Which I think is why they probably will. There's no way Paul's ever going to happen. Paul will rally the troops. And
but
get
again,
in there.
We talked about this before. You know, this in the modern era, you don't have to put out a full album. Put
no,
out an EP or
put out songs.
Cut a song is a la carte tunes.
That's what Samurai Son is. You know,
I think though, just from the mindset of those guys being from the 70s, I think they'll put out an album.
Yeah, no, you're right.
I think it's
not necessary.
Yeah, I agree.
But
I agree.
You know, I'm hoping they don't because that's 10 fucking episodes.
That's another 2.5 months. You gotta do this shit. You guys should get a medal. I wonder if Kiss knows about this podcast. Do they know?
I don't think so.
I'm going to ask Paul if he's heard of it.
Oh, boy.
I'm sure
don't ask Gene if he's heard of it.
I'll shut it down immediately.
If you think the shit I've talked about you is bad.
I've heard. When You Wish Upon a Star.
Oh.
Okay, worst Kiss song ever, probably, official release?
Well, so far we've...
Boomerang?
Boomerang is still at
That's
the bottom.
Awful. Boomerang's yeah, shit.
When You Wish Upon a Star gets... It doesn't get a pass, but it's not... It's not penned by anybody in the band.
The concept and why he did it, I understand. Yeah. It's admirable and there's a reason. But Boomerang is just a shit song.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
So forgettable,
yeah,
too.
Terrible. But most of Gene's songs in the 80s were, so.
Right.
All right. So
we will not be
rolling?
Experiencing that this week.
Apparently. No, we will not. Let's get
I'm
started.
I'm going to put my glasses on.
I'm actually glad we're watching the video. That's fun. It's a fun video.
I thought you said you hated it when we watched the video.
Well, but I'm going to be the voice of reason and keep it.
He's
going to
right the
track.
Ship, if you will.
Jesus, dude, make up your mind.
Well, fuck, man. I'm nervous. You got three. I'm like the new guy in the band. You guys have been together for 3 years. I got to walk in as the new guy and try to impress
you. That's what
you?
I'm saying. Dealing with these two assholes.
Jeez, I feel like fucking Mark St. John right now. Break, dude.
Let's hope your hand doesn't start blowing up like a balloon or whatever.
Would you rather stay normal so I can peel off some of those awesome leads from
go.
Animalize?
Those horn-influenced leads, jazz horns.
The best lead on Animalize is freaking Heaven's on Fire.
Yeah.
That's the best lead in the record.
Yeah.
Most
melodic, probably most rudimentary.
It's probably
best.
Played by Paul as well.
That's probably true,
which
too.
Which is why it's the best one.
Well, if it's a video podcast, I need to put my glasses on to see the screen.
They're
and,
on?
And also verify that's actually Chris Jericho sitting there.
What?
It could
that
be.
Far
it
away.
Could be an impersonator. my eyes are not
be,
that great.
It could be like the guy who was imitating Peter Criss on one of the Donahue show. And then they actually brought out Peter
Did
Criss.
You, have you ever watched
sword.
Have you ever watched that whole thing?
I've watched it on YouTube.
It's
like
it's unbelievable, the whole episode. It's insane.
Just the fact that they bring him out there. And they go, what are you doing, man? Why would you do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's another statement of how old I am, that I'm older than everybody in this room that now includes Chris Jericho, worldwide superstar.
D-level.
I watched that episode when it aired live.
Because
they played it up, and I was obviously way into Kiss at the time, and so I either skipped school or faked being sick so I could get home
just
early.
To watch it.
Awesome. Wow, you
and
faked being
it.
Sick just like the guy faked being Peter Criss. Such
now,
irony.
I once faked being sick so I could watch the Blue Lagoon on cable.
Nice. Yeah,
cranked it off to Brooke Shields.
Although, do you know that
felt much better after that.
They had her hair actually, I remember reading about it that she called them buppy pads.
Yeah.
The hair was attached to her boobs. So we didn't have a chance.
Yeah. It still worked for me. Fuck, she was fine with it.
So was the dude was hot too. Fucking
Miss
tan.
Atkins,
shit,
Chris Atkins.
Never saw him again, I don't think.
Can't guarantee that he didn't contribute to my titillation watching that.
I agree.
You know, I'm man enough to admit it.
Man, some guys are
just
hot.
A shit.
It's the way it is.
Yeah,
just,
we talk about
it's
dicks.
It's just the fucking
the
way it is.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly, man.
I'm all good with it, so.
Kids these days will never know the struggles, huh? You had to stay home from school and masturbate to a movie on basic cable.
That had no nudity in it.
Yeah, no nudity.
Just the concept of Brooke Shields with, like, naked stomach.
Yeah, just
that was
partial
the best part,
part of her body.
The illusion of nudity.
The naked stomach.
That was something that you always stuck to. When we worked at Playboy, you would talk about it. You liked a little bit of the cover-up.
Oh, yeah, dude. Man. That's the best part.
Exactly.
Because I was like, oh, we can go on. We had, like, this asset management system. We could see all the pictures they would never show because there's too much.
I love how you guys used to work at Playboy.
It was ridiculous.
Yeah, a long time, man.
That's great, so. Man. I never would guess from Chicago. You think it'd be L.A.?
No, they were Chicago-based from the 50s till 2012.
No kidding. What do you guys think about Playboy now not having any nude pictures in it?
Yeah, it's just,
what's the point?
I think it's just a last-ditch effort to get a headline before they fold. Like, I don't know. That was the last thing left to do, I think.
Well, it's all about the website now, right?
Yeah.
The internet,
and they're a merchandising brand, right?
Chicks are
still wearing Playboy pants.
God bless them.
And there'll always be a Playboy centerfold of the month and all that stuff because chicks always want that. But it'll move online now, viral.
Yep. All right. So.
All right. We got a video here and a song. This is going to be fun.
It's all good. We got it all set
up. Paul looks really
cool
in this video, too. He's got his hair extensions in and shit.
We'll be the judge of that. We'll debate that.
Sorry.
See how
I'm ahead of the curve here. Like I said, I just literally watched it last night. And let me just say this to the fans listening at home. Honestly, did not know what song we were listening to today. At least I had no idea.
And so you can
verify this is real.
Yes, there are no shenanigans. We've been accused of it many times.
No shenanigans, because a man of my my means, a man of my star power and star quality and
it's
fame.
It's considerable.
The E-plus fan base that I have, I would not waste my time coming in here if I didn't believe this was legit.
Well, good. Thank you.
You like that, huh?
There it is.
The laptop needs a little work.
Yeah.
There's a little latency there.
Oh. It's a work in progress. The mobile kit here.
It's only been 3 years.
Oh, yeah.
All right, well, cue it up. Let's get rocking here, man. I think we've been talking for an hour already.
Yeah.
Now,
Oh wait!
That's what we do.
Fill me in.
Sorry, that's what we do.
Wave.
Okay. Procedure. You wave at me.
Wave at Andy. Yeah.
okay.
Now,
of course, if Andy's preoccupied with something, which doesn't take much for him, you have to really get his attention.
Okay. So we're gonna say
now sonically. This I always thought was a sister song to My Way.
Yes.
Because we're getting the same. It sounds like the exact same mix here with the little overpowering synthesizer.
That's a good
keyboard
call.
Thing. Yeah. But I don't mind it, but just wanted to point that out.
I love My Way, too, by the way.
What do you think about
Bruce has sweet red pants?
Sweet red pants on Bruce there.
Bruce is just the fucking man. He really is. Like, you know, anybody that even if you demean 80s Kiss, you have to always give him props. Everything he did, he tried his hardest and played his ass off, whatever he was asked to do.
And he adapted to whatever they were trying
to
do at the time.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
You know, if it's a song like this, or if it's a song like Forever, or if it's a song like Unholy, he always captures the vibe perfectly.
Oh, no question.
Would you say he's maybe, from a guitar player standpoint, the most universally
the best
praised,
player.
Universally praised of all the Kiss lead guitar players.
I mean, he doesn't have the hero status.
Probably
iconic.
No, he doesn't have that ace like original status thing. But as far as if you're going to talk to guitar players,
they probably
go with Bruce Kulick.
He's the best guitar player as far as technique and all that sort of stuff in Kiss. I mean, Ace is Ace, obviously, but Bruce blows him away.
I'd also like to, if we can nerd out on guitar stuff.
Of course, I'll be back.
Yeah, get out of here.
He's going to go wax his stash.
Yeah, right.
It's growing out for Halloween.
Looks good.
Thank you.
What are you going to be?
Bruce Kulick.
A male model with a mustache.
Okay. Well, Bruce Kulick what?
I would say he's my second favorite wah user. Mm. You know, he's always parked right in that sweet spot. Never goes too far treble or bass. always in there, always very vocal.
Who's your favorite?
Would be Brian Robertson, Thin Lizzy.
Interesting. Good old Robbo, huh?
Yeah, the best.
From nice. The Another Perfect Day Motorhead album, right?
Yeah. He got a little weird on that one with the ballerina slippers and the headbands and Motorhead.
Lemmy used to talk about him and say, I don't know what the fuck you would show up wearing all these fives. He thought that he wore stupid shit just to mess with Lemmy.
Yeah, he had to. I don't know what happened to him.
He was gone after an album, so yeah.
But boy, his is a Thin Lizzy. He's my all-time favorite guitarist, guitar player.
Okay, good. That's a pretty obscure call there.
Yeah, he's another one in that band who, people point to John Sykes and Gary Moore. Great guitar players, obviously, but all the iconic stuff was done with Robbo and the band.
Here we go. Little homage there with they showed the guys in makeup in the crowd.
Yeah.
Which was cool because for a while there, they were very anti-makeup. Like, you would never see anything from about 84,
that's
85,
true.
86. Yeah. So that might be the first time they made a little bit allusion to the past.
That's a good observation.
This could be the turning point that led to, like, the full-fledged montage in the God Gave Rock and Roll to You video.
Right.
Where they were really, really laying it on. Like, remember this greatness.
Yeah. Well, then there was that bit in the rise to it.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Take the makeup.
You're crazy. Take the makeup off.
How many times can we say makeup? makeup. Which I always, that's a whole other thing, but Gene seems like such an asshole in that video. Like, he just hates Kiss. Take the makeup off. Like, we're not wearing makeup now, Gene. You can't be talking like this because you sound like we suck now.
Right.
But look at the shot here. Paul's wearing a nice check out his cape that he's
like
wearing.
A trench coat length capes. Thing.
Yeah. That was the thing. He probably had a whole closet full of those.
I
those
love
like
those things.
Floor length trench
spangled out.
Yeah,
not a bad look. I think in general, men's fashions, the cape should make a comeback.
Yeah, just in general.
It's not
a
bad look.
It really isn't. If it was accepted,
I have a Dracula.
Cool.
I have a Dracula cape at home. Legitimate.
Brought it with
a legitimate actual cape. Yeah.
Maybe Andy can borrow it for Halloween.
He could be a male model with a cape and a mustache.
not like cartoonish, costumish cape. Like an actual.
Like
tailored,
a gentleman's
nicely
cape.
Put together cape, yes.
Like if you were a big time
not a bad idea.
Theater.
You
like if you're a star of the theater years ago, you know, you
walk
have the
around
cape.
In a cape, people are like, who the fuck is that guy?
it's like wearing a scarf.
Yeah.
There you go. Who would do that?
And along those lines, and something we talked about earlier, the ascot. Very
ooh,
underrated
nice. Yeah.
Men's accessory.
Hugh Hefner as a famous ascot guy.
Yeah.
So I think he
is. Nick's a big fan of the dickie.
I wear the dickie.
I'm sure you do. All right, hit
it. I didn't realize I set myself up. Really.
Keep it going.
Some shenanigans going on here.
Total rocker right
it's
there.
It's like Corey Feldman right there.
Yeah, Paul
also,
doing his walk.
Yeah, Paul doing his walk. And we don't want to talk too much about the video.
No,
but
no.
There was a woman in a road case who popped out. So there's some B story going on here, aside from the live setting.
And musically, the synth, but it's kind of a chugging, little bit of a...
Yeah, typically I hate this type of synthesizer treatment, but I'm not minding this. And I'm not just saying that because
you're here. No, dude, I know. Trust me. You hit me with the D-lit lister right when I got in.
Yeah.
I was like, holy shit.
Yeah, what's wrong?
This guy is an asshole.
If you want me to hold his arms behind his back.
We're on the same team now.
I didn't want you to go all Jim Norton on me, though. So I was a little worried about that, but, you know. But no, typically, you know, as you've, I'm sure, maybe agree, but this type of synthesizer, very fine tipping point.
Absolutely.
From total cheese.
And I'm not a fan of it, believe me. I'm not a fan of it.
But it sounds good here.
That was what they did on this record. Once again, this is why I always stand up for the Crazy Nights record, because Kiss has always been the masters of kind of morphing, not morphing, but evolving into whatever was going on and still staying true to themselves. So people love the Dynasty record. There's a lot of disco on that. It's just there's blatant disco. People love the Revenge era. There's a lot of Pantera heavy 92 guitars on that. And this is what was going on in 87, and they took it and they blended in that style along with what they were doing as it was. So that's why I actually almost like Crazy Nights even more, because they just did what they always do and just stayed contemporary and stayed above water.
Relevant is another
irrelevant,
word.
Exactly. They stayed relevant.
Absolutely. There's not, you know, you can't point to a lot of bands who were able, especially a band that had such a shtick like Kiss, the makeup, to abandon that and also switch gears musically and stay on top is pretty damn impressive.
And if you look at this too, a lot of bands at this time frame, ZZ Top, Van Halen, Rush, they all incorporated a lot of the 80s, the synth and all that stuff. And there's diehards that just hate 80s Rush and hate 80s, you know, Van Halen. I love it because that's why they've lasted for 30, 40 years, because they were able to, like you said, stay relevant. There's only one AC/DC that can do the same thing for 40 years.
Totally.
You can't get away with it, you know, if you're not.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, well, you could put like a Motorhead or Ramones.
Sure, there's
in
a
there.
Few.
Yeah.
But like, Ramones was not.
Ramones got pretty 80s cheesy a few times.
They did for a while.
They had the bells in the background.
And they had an electronic drum kit on some of those. Yeah. Kind of strange sounding with punk, but.
But man, Motorhead never changed. Slayer never changed. But I mean, you know, basically, Kiss, it's like the Stones, the same thing in the 80s. They were doing a whole bunch of synthesizer type stuff.
Well, and they talk about their disco albums and stuff.
Yeah,
and
Rod Stewart, a lot of guys did that. So
earlier you mentioned Seventh Son. How did you feel about that when the keyboards came into Maiden?
I loved
it
because it was more of a mood type thing. It was like they called them synth guitars, right?
Mm-hmm.
But like I told you, I love that record. I love the
Moonchild.
Fuck, it's great.
Yeah.
The mood that it sets is tremendous.
So awesome.
One of the reasons why I don't have a strong stance against the whole synthesizer sound in it, but this song particularly, and like My Way, and it's got such strong rock pop melodies.
See, that's the
and
thing,
vocal
yeah.
delivery. It's so strong. Like they weren't just doing it because that was the sound of the time. They were crafting actual catchy songs.
Yes,
also.
There's more hooks than a tackle box on these songs.
There you go.
And Paul's vocals are
Did you say taco box?
A taco box, yeah.
Okay.
I had a taco downtown the other day. There was a hook in it. It got me right. I'm going to sue the son of a bitch. Paul's vocals are so high, and I challenge you in general, name another vocalist that sang that high for most of the 80s. I mean, Bruce Dickinson was a high singer. But I mean, for a band like this, he blew Bon Jovi away. He blew, you know, Bret Michaels away, or I mean, you get your Halford and those sort of guys. But Paul's melodies are so high,
yeah.
And that's great singing. It's great singing.
You know, you mentioned it earlier that My Way is a vocal.
Oh my gosh,
tour
de
force. Nobody can question that.
Yeah. And there's like that's why Paul. They don't do any of these songs anymore because it's impossible to sing them.
No
for
way.
Paul at this point,
it'd probably be impossible then. I mean,
yeah.
In the studio, you have all the time you want, but to pull that off live, would be really difficult.
No. It's not possible, especially as you get older.
That's
and
right,
you know, a lot of people are, you know, they're like, oh, they're tuning down, blah blah blah. It's like, well, do you want the fucking song or not? You
right.
know, you can't. These are not supermen.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
People bitching about Halford. Oh, they tune down, and he has to bend over to hit those notes. Who fucking cares?
Because your voice is a muscle, basically.
Right.
And it's like being like a bodybuilder at 65 or 70. It just doesn't happen anymore.
Right.
So yes, and that's the same with Ozzy. Ozzy's melody lines in early Sabbaths is insane.
Yeah.
To sing that
high. You can't
high.
Do it.
So that's why I love another. It's another example of Paul at his vocal peak, probably hitting it. I'd say at around 85. To about 95 was when he was at his wheelhouse, perfect singing.
Yeah, it's you know Priest. It's like, okay, Rob Halford standing upright or delete victim of changes from the set.
Right.
I mean, which are you gonna pick?
Yeah, exactly.
Who fucking cares?
That's right.
He's bent over.
Yeah.
God, something wrong with people.
Complaining about everything. All right.
We're getting a throwback to the Shandy video from a few weeks ago. We have the woman backstage.
You're right. Lurking in the shadows.
Lurking, and we don't know what she's up to.
She's almost kind of like the...
I know what she's
Catherine's
up to. She took her clothes off.
Well,
I'm good with that.
She wants to get a backstage pass from Kiss, man.
That's how you do it.
I'll tell you what.
I wish I was
a chick in the 80s. I used to stand outside by the bus because I was a dude.
They want nothing to do with you when you're a dude trying
to
get in. Yeah.
Jeez, how dare I? You know?
This chick in this video, it's almost like what's that movie with Sean Connery and Catherine Zeta-Jones? She's got like the black
entrapment.
Entrapment. She's got like an entrapment vibe. She's like spy coming out of the thing in a black one piece
and crawling around those laser detectors with her ass rising up.
Well,
and
that's
down.
Why she's famous. That one shot, right?
Really?
There.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that put her on the map, but yeah, that's an incredible sequence. No question.
We'll see if that's duplicated in this movie or in this video.
Sorry.
there's a line of lyrics for you.
Oh. Yeah, let's get into lyrics. Yeah. As Chris observed earlier, sometimes, you know, with the video going on, we get away from the actual tune, and especially the lyrics.
Yeah, so. and this was a pretty good set of lyrics right here. This
everybody's
pre-chorus.
Thinking you're so hot tonight, but there's a fire in your eyes.
You got it already.
Well, I know it.
Okay.
They don't have it yet.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody loves you, girl, but I love you more than any other guy.
Oh, what woman wouldn't melt to hear that? I mean, come on. He's speaking of women, I'd like to point out that Jean is the second best-looking woman in this video.
He's really thin here. He's,
yeah,
fit.
He's thin. His hair's dialed in. He's
but
got
also, too, in also in not to interrupt you, I think I know where you're going. In this era, he finally got rid of the fluorescent mod clothes. He's wearing leather pants and a leather jacket. And mm-hmm. he's got his axe base, and he's got a, like, looks like kind of a dragon base. He looks pretty fucking cool there.
Yeah, the demon's kind of coming back.
He does, yeah.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
Asylum, you know, lick it up, animalize, probably his bottom visually.
Animalize, I'd go the worst, right? Because his hair, he wasn't wearing a wig, and even just watching those videos last night, he's just terrible in those three videos.
He could just tell he's uncomfortable to be there. Like, there's just something wrong.
When he did Talk is Jericho, that's what he said. He said, I was lost. I didn't know who I was supposed to be, what I was supposed to do. He said that translated to my songs. I had no confidence, which is interesting to hear him say.
From Gene Simmons.
Yeah.
I did not know he said that on your show. Interesting.
Everyone's thinking they're so hot tonight, but there's a fire in your eyes. Everybody wants you, girl, but I want you more than any other guy.
Oh, come on.
You got what I want. I got what you need. Fire below.
Fire below.
So if you know it, show it. Don't let me go. Whoa.
Oh, that's good stuff. You got what I want.
I got
what you need. Well, I like that he puts himself up a little bit. You know, yeah. I want that, but
classic
you can't
Stanley,
survive without
this.
This
is textbook.
I want this. Yeah. You need this.
This is textbook seduction. It is.
It's fire below. Yeah, I love that too.
This is the difference between a Paul Stanley lyric and a Biz Markie lyric.
That's
you
that's
got what I need? No, I got what you need.
That's right,
exactly.
Yeah, baby. Yeah.
It's that whole flip flop there.
Just written perfectly.
Oh, yeah. Fire below. It's mm-hmm. so great because it's not just like, oh, he's trying to find something that rhymes. Like, there's confidence and meaning in fire below
in the songwriting
here.
That's not just a rhyming lyric.
Yeah.
That's an actual statement. Fire below.
That must have been like something he said.
Yeah, these are not just thrown together.
Now, fire below is interesting. Is he just talking about himself?
No, he's talking about her because he's got what she needs. There's a fire below. He can tell.
She's heating up.
Her for JJ is on fire.
Yeah.
She's got some hooks in her taco box. Going on there.
And it almost sounds like fire below it's like incoming, like a torpedo
is going to
be fired.
Fire in the
fire
hole.
Below.
Yeah. Oh, fire in the hole. That would have been good too. That would have been good too.
It's all good. we know where he's going with this. Yeah. Let's take it to the next level.
Oh, can you just back it up a little bit? Because it's a really cool little just 2 seconds. I don't want you guys to miss the little Bruce Kulick guitar.
Oh, of course.
Little squeal he does here, which is really cool. Zach Wilde, by the way, just so you know.
Yeah, just
that's
right
true.
Before it.
That's actually more of a John Sykes, I think, was doing it at that time
in
84,
good call.
85.
Yeah.
Look at the fat guy
out there.
Some security guard sleeping on the job over here.
I mean, here's an exercise in contrast. You got some fat motherfucker on a folding chair hot woman walking.
This guy's obviously like protected by the union. He could sleep on the job and it's all good.
Why did you wave it off, Nick?
Oh, I waved it off because, visually, I like to point this out when we go to this era. This was the era where Paul had the guitar, but a lot of times it was behind his back.
Never played it.
Because he was going for that front man, you know, that 80s, you know, kind of pretty front man.
Which
kind
in
of
the
thing.
X and Sex and Rock Hard,
he doesn't even have one. Yeah.
He said, fuck it.
He's standing there. Yeah. He's got like the fingerless gloves. He's kind of like clapping
with the
along.
Fringe
and
hanging off.
And that's another thing I like about this forgotten thing, you know, talking demeaning Kiss in the 80s. If Paul hadn't been Paul and worked his ass off to keep the band rolling, they would have broken up. or they would have stopped for a while.
That would be like a, did you ever hear of Kiss? Right. And going back and hear...
Because he knew that all those bands had a great front man, which Paul always has been, but with the guitar, it puts you in a different world. Like, mm-hmm. but who's the greatest frontman of all time? Well, Freddie Mercury, or it's David Lee Roth, or it's Mick Jagger. Those guys don't play guitar.
Right.
Paul Stanley is the best front man who plays guitar of all time, I would have to say, except for maybe Springsteen, if you want to talk about that. But for rock and roll, heavy metal, that sort of thing.
Yeah, no.
And he really, he knew exactly what he had to do here. He looked great. He was like, you know, he was sexy. He was hot. He dressed. He drew the ladies in.
Yep.
Once again, because the star child is still Paul Stanley.
Yep.
The demon, there's no demon, but Paul could do this because that's what he played in the 70s as well.
Good point. Excellent observations.
What just happened?
There's our now.
Did that fat ass even wake up after all that chaos? Or I didn't even. I wasn't paying attention to him.
There's our sound effects over top of the video, right? Yeah.
I don't recall. It's making me think of a movie where a place is getting robbed, and like, oh no, it's Seinfeld. Seinfeld episode. A place is getting robbed, and the guy's sitting there in the chair sleeping throughout the whole thing.
Oh, and it's the department store,
yeah,
whatever.
Or whatever it was. But see, we have a really catchy big vocal chorus here, but then we had the lightning and all the, you know,
right
all
over
the
top
stuff.
Of the first
right
chorus.
Over the top of the introduction of the first
good
big
call.
Hook chorus.
That could be a little bit of a faux pas.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just about to ask if Paul was rocking any body glove gear, and here we are.
It actually says body glove on this
massive body
t-shirt.
Glove logo on his ripped t-shirt. He's simply breathtaking in this era.
Super
he
hot,
really man. Had it all figured out.
Yeah.
What is she carrying?
I think it's
there?
An axe.
Is it an axe?
It looks like an axe. Is she going to come try and murder the band?
That's kind of a...
Almost looks
like a dark turn.
Almost like a dustpan for like a chimney sweep.
Maybe she murdered the fat guy in the chair.
Or one of those things you used to pick up dog shit in your backyard, you know?
That's if she did murder that guy, no one's going to notice for a while. It's like, oh, there he is, like, sitting there doing nothing.
Especially him. Again. He's probably still sleeping. Oh, my God, what the hell's going on?
Yeah, I mean, look at him. He probably had a heart attack. Who can tell if he's been murdered? Come on.
Okay, now musically, we need to comment musically. Another high flying great, you know, vocal thing. But he walks away from the microphone, which is another bit of '80s video magic.
But the thing
it
is, too,
matter.
The school is he's following the camera, so he's kind of strutting along with the camera. It's one of my favorite shots in the vid. It's
that is my favorite. That walk with the camera.
Yeah, the guy on the you got the track.
The track.
Andy, you're in the business. What do you call that?
A dolly track.
A dolly track.
You know, he just did the jumping splits, which was a huge thing in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
You
especially for Kiss.
Yeah. You don't see any modern bands don't do any, like, physical feats during their videos.
If you watch Kiss around this time frame, you know, Animalized or the Crazy Nights tour from Tokyo bootleg, they are doing split jump kicks. Like, Gene does, like, this jumping David Lee Roth kick where his leg is right high up by his ear and... It's just, they were really gymnastic back at that time frame, you know?
Yeah.
And, I don't got to tell you this, but you got to be in shape
absolutely.
To do that shit.
Especially wearing a, you know, a 20-pound guitar. It's not easy. Listen to how Paul sings this next word, ignite.
Let's listen to that, and then I want to talk all about a previous lyric.
Love it.
Nice.
little vibrato there.
Yeah, holding on to the note a little bit.
But, you know,
it's kind of like tender sounding.
Yeah.
Because he's saying, "Let's sparks ignite," which is kind of an explosive thing to say. But
before then, he was speaking of put your finger on the switch, and you know, can't help think of switch being a euphemism for the prostate gland.
Is that where this is going?
Of course.
You know, he's spoken of the stink finger in previous tunage.
That's how some people turn on the night.
If you want to get backstage at a Kiss show.
Yeah. Take me in your arms, I'll take you into my heart. Let's bring this love to life. Come on, baby, put your finger on the switch. Let's make some sparks ignite.
Oh, man. Again,
that'll shoot off a Roman candle. You put your finger on that switch.
Fire below for sure.
But yeah, he's definitely he definitely knows how to speak to a woman, doesn't he? Yeah,
especially, I mean, this is especially with the look on his face too. This is a really really good video, I think, as far as being a good indication of where the band was for the song. It's a fun video. I don't know why it didn't get played.
We had a Tears Are Fallen and an Ace Frehley reference in the same
at the
shot.
Same time.
And there's also like an Elton John looking guy with a silver wig or something. Yeah, what the hell is that guy doing?
He had the spaceman makeup.
During this
era of Kiss, when Fraley's comet was arguably bigger, I think they said, for a short period there.
Really?
That's what I've heard, that they were actually their tour. They had some sort of tours.
Maybe this album sold more, where they were
a little bit bigger at that time. Like, wow. there's a story. John Regan, the bass player from Fraley's Comet. Of course, he's gonna say that. Well, yeah. I don't know that anybody's contradicted it.
I would love to have Paul Stanley here right now and have his record. You saying well, he would say, "Are you fucking crazy?"
Yeah, right.
Ace Frehley ever bigger than Kiss?
All I can say is, you know, the stuff from what I've read. But there was an incident where there was a shared rehearsal studio, is kind of a complex. And Fraley's Comet had the slightly bigger one, and it was an issue.
I'm sure.
You know,
I can see that for sure.
So absolutely. I don't know. I mean, but it's interesting because Fraley's Comet was riding pretty high at this point.
I think Fraley's Comet is almost gold, and this is platinum. So that right there shows you.
On the flip side of it, this might have been an early indication from Gene and Paul putting that in there and advertising to the world. We own this makeup, motherfuckers.
Oh, that's right. Good call. We can play this whenever we want. We can have this whenever we want to.
We can put other guys in this makeup if we want. We can do whatever we want.
That would never happen. No, that's realistic.
Yeah, that's talk about conspiracy.
Who's gonna be next, Turtle Boy?
Boots are great.
Like Paul's moon boots.
Yeah. I was going to say they're almost Ace Frehley-esque.
I have
a lot of nods to Ace in this thing.
I have pajama pants that look similar to that.
I love the fact that guys just wear spandex, like just a pair of spandex pants.
Yeah.
That's it. Like, no one would ever wear that now.
No.
Balls hanging out and shit.
And I'm not so sure that's a good thing that men don't wear that.
I like Iron Maiden. Especially rockers. Steve Harris wear like them striped spandex.
Yeah.
Everyone was just wearing spandex, throwing a pair of spandex and going on stage, man. That was it. Yeah. Whether you had a hot ass or not.
Yeah, I mean, the modern equivalent of this is the fucking skinny girls' jeans that these hipsters wear.
Just,
you know,
like the spandex.
Doesn't have the swagger.
Yeah.
It's missing from today's
rock music. Just the fearlessness.
Exactly.
I'm gonna wear spandex. If it's cold out and my cock is small, I don't give a shit. Check me out, man. Especially if you have a guitar, you don't have to worry about it. That's why Paul kept the guitar.
There you go, yeah.
Could just be the only reason.
He's rubbing it on there, I think.
Yeah, he could be.
Okay. Things just went absolutely crazy here.
Yeah, what is this? What just happened?
They're on the rooftop.
Suddenly.
Revealing that they're on the rooftop. Of the World Trade Center or something like this.
Yeah.
There's helicopters and there's a giant Kiss sign. Yeah, so she hit the soundboard with the axe and then revealed that we're on top of a roof.
So we have the maintenance man of the venue not paying attention.
Yeah.
And we've got the sound guys, the guys at the soundboard, obviously not paying attention.
They're not even there.
Or she just John Wilkes Booth them from behind.
She must have. And then also pressed the button that took the roof off the place.
Yeah.
We're going to tear the roof off this joint.
Yeah.
Literally.
And there's helicopters. Now, when was the Moscow Peace Festival? What year was that?
89.
89. So okay, never mind then. I was going to draw a parallel to how everybody landed with in the helicopters.
Maybe
back
they
then.
Got the idea from this video.
Oh, who knows?
Maybe Doc McGee pre-managing Kiss. Because
in the
this.
Footage from that, I'd seen some recently. They really played that up, that it was so massive the guys had to come in on the helicopters. Shocker. The helicopter is
except to Gorky Park. Because
they were there already.
They had to go on mopeds.
Yeah.
They took the bus. We got bus tickets for show.
Yeah,
exactly.
How many? Two bus tickets. Five guys in band.
I'm no expert on, I don't know, what would you call it, dimensions. But if you look at this, The guys in the band are like 30 feet tall. Because this is the top of a skyscraper. Yeah,
that's true. Well,
the they're like too, four stories tall.
And there was also like 12,000 people in the arena. And now there's like 40 people yeah. in the crowd. Yeah. What happened to the rest yeah, of the people?
They all fell over the edge.
This shot is... The shot is not to scale, as
this
they
say. This chick is like a massive circular. Yeah. She's like Idi Amin up here.
Exactly. It's
she's like genocide.
And there's the weird curved kind of background that we don't see in any
it's
other shots.
It's a really
shots.
Weird...
The wall is just really short in this
bad
shot.
Bad color.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what's going
there.
On.
Matte painting.
Yeah. during the helicopter sound effects.
During the chorus again.
Yeah.
Jeez.
The main hook of the song.
Give the guys a break here.
Can't it's a good thing they put that in because otherwise I would have never known there were helicopters
right.
That scene,
yeah,
you know? Thanks for that. Appreciate it.
Looks like Eric Carr is really giving her on this video. Every scene you see him, he's just rocking real hard. You know?
He kind of did that in every video. Yeah, he never really phoned it in any videos that I can tell.
You're right, and it's funny watching some of those 70s Dynasty videos. Peter's just so out of it. Like, he's stoned out of his gourd and sure know something. As a matter of fact, Andy Biersack, who's a huge Kiss fan from Black Veil Brides, used to be scared of Peter Criss in the Sure Know Something video because he looks so wasted and lifeless.
And when there's that shot in the middle where they do that little harmony thing, and when the faces kind of come at you in the dark.
And Peter, just like attacking you with like this dead, lifeless zombie eyes. But Eric never did that, man. He always gave it his all, you know?
He's in Rusty Blade mode at this point.
He really is. John Links.
Now, speaking of him, though, we usually... this is one I know Chris likes to comment on, particularly from this era. What do you think of the drums? The sound of the drums usually gets some attention.
You know, I haven't really keyed in on it. It's nothing that's jumping out at me as lousy. I mean,
they're pretty
bombastic. It's not the drum sound I prefer. You know,
it's not your animalized drum sound or, you know, those type of ones.
No.
I know you like the creature sound.
The creature sound is...
Well, that's what I'm saying, but this is not as bad as the animalized.
Oh, certainly not.
So it's somewhere
in the middle. It's not jumping out at me as terrible, but... No, I mean, I've got no objections here. Strong chorus. You can tell that, you know, certainly Paul is engaged, not phoning in the vocal by any stretch of imagination.
Great point. And that's another thing, too. We laugh about Diane Warren, but as far as a hook writer, I mean, dude, she's doing a great job in this one.
Absolutely. She's who she is for a reason.
Every vocal moment is, as the kids say, an earworm at this point.
Ah, yeah, you're right.
Good Everything.
Point. Yeah, I like it. And again, this is literally my first time hearing this song, certainly seeing the video. But, the style of the video is familiar. Mm. You know, it's that Bon Jovi.
Yeah.
Who is that? Wayne
Isham.
Yeah.
And Marty Callner was the other guy, and that's who did this, was Marty
style.
Callner. Yeah.
So, you know, sans the destruction of the soundboard and the chaos that brought about. But, no, the song is fine. You know, I've got no issue with, you know, there are guys who, if it's just because it's a pop song, they'll hate it. Guess what?
See,
most of the songs you like are pop songs.
Every song that you like should be boiled down to a pop song. I'm talking Slayer or anything. You could listen to Angel of Death and you could have a pop band play it and the hooks are still going to be
exactly
there.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Have we determined what the woman in this video is trying to accomplish?
She must be.
Is that it?
I don't know. Does she need attention?
This seems like. What was the video where the chick? Oh, is
with the car? Is the car on fire?
Reason to live.
Yeah. Reason to live.
The other single from this.
Is this the same chick? She's not done with him.
Yeah. Now she's going to destroy the. She's going to pull a Black Friday and destroy the whole damn Super Bowl arena.
Yeah, it's like, well, Jesus, lady, relax.
And this is quite a dangerous setting to be goofing around like
especially
this.
On top of a building.
On top of a building.
A skyscraper.
A tiny building.
Yeah. A woman who looks like that could get a replacement dick in about 20 seconds.
At any rock show.
Why are you fixated
on... She could go fuck Richie Sambora in the Bon Jovi video tomorrow.
Exactly right.
Yeah, but Hell Hath No Fury.
Move on with your life, goddammit.
Yeah. Hell Hath No Fury, and she's just carrying that out.
Oh, yeah,
okay.
Just, get over it. Yeah. Solo.
That crosswalk that he does. Paul when he's doing the camera following move and his legs are like crossing over each
karaoke,
other.
Karaoke.
Is that what that was?
I think that's the run, the karaoke.
You know what I like about the vocal too is he just goes like, yeah. Just
yeah.
A little nowhere thing just kills it.
Oh, yeah. It's perfect. And since you mentioned it in that last segment, I keyed in on the drum sound. It's that big 80s gated reverb snare sound. It sounds okay to me.
The playing is good. Eric's playing good on it, too.
Yeah. He's not, you know, using every turret on his fucking tank drum set or every Simmons pad that's behind him. Just playing it straight, and it's all good. I got no issues with it. Okay, what did Paul say there?
First, babe, I think.
We'll go back and listen. But first of all, tasty solo.
Oh, yeah.
That's one of my probably favorite, like, hair, I guess you want to call it Kiss hair 80s era, you know, from Animalize to this point. It's one of the solos that you can sort of hum if you know it well enough. It's not a face melter.
Yeah,
but it sounds great.
It's a tasty solo.
Very tasty, yeah.
It's really well played. It's like you said, it's not a shred solo, which is usually a waste of time with Kiss when they try and do that.
But there's some technical playing in there. It's perfectly executed, composed. It's what we've come to expect from Bruce Kulick.
Exactly. But that was pretty funny, though. I don't think I've ever really keyed in on that before. Like, what does he go, hey, baby? What does he say? Hey, guys.
Let's hear it again.
Now, is that in the actual album version? Okay.
I've never noticed it, though. Even watching the video, I've never noticed that.
Even your late night viewing session
so you got to look at it this way. If I start on Sure Know Something, I'm drinking.
Yeah.
By the time I get to the third video from Crazy Nights, I'm already looped.
Nobody's attention span is going to be.
I don't even know what the video for Hide Your Heart is. I can't remember a thing about it. I've seen it probably 30 times. Yeah. Never even mind freaking I Just Wanna.
Good point.
By the time I get to that. Hey, babe!
Wonderful. I like that it's still in the solo.
Now look how they're portraying that as like he's calling out to her because apparently she was leaving and now she's looking
she's
back.
Coming back.
It's
right.
Like, why do you want her to come back? She's fucking busting up everything in the in the arena.
He's still
murdering
your audience.
Wants
sent thousands plummeting to their deaths.
He still wants her.
Yeah, well, it's always the crazy
one. It's just such an overly passionate relationship, apparently.
Look at her. Okay.
Down.
Now he's taking over. Oh, definitely no bra.
No bra.
Not allowed back then.
Look at the dude over his shoulder with the stash.
Nice photo bomb. Look at that guy.
How about Joyce DeWitt over there? Joyce DeWitt or the drummer from Cinderella.
You take a screenshot of that guy back there?
You know he's got his groin pressed up against her ass too.
I think that they're behind the barricade.
We need a screenshot of this guy.
They're not getting past there. They don't
have
backstage pass.
He's already soiled himself.
And then the people on the right side, they're not even lit. I feel bad for them. They didn't even get in the shot.
No.
There you go. She looks good, though, man. She looks good.
She does
looks
look good.
She was hotter than hell.
Just when you thought Paul couldn't make it work that high, or higher, higher than he was singing already. He goes up during this pre-chorus here.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, what can you say?
Yeah. Just go back again. I just want to hear that because I want to make sure.
I mean, it's a variation where he goes even higher than
call,
where he was
man.
Going
Good
already.
Call.
That's incredible.
At the end of, I think it was Show It, when he sings that.
The voice cracked.
He does
just
the little Paul Stanley almost yodel, which he's so great at doing.
Yeah,
totally
I heard
control.
That too.
Yeah,
know?
Totally in control.
You know what's funny? Something I noticed there, it's like how it's a performance video, but they're taking liberties like, okay, I'm not going to play the guitar now. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to sing
into
the
mic.
Yet the mic is covered with guitar picks.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like
that's part of their production at this point in time.
Right, but
a giant Kiss symbol and guitar picks is about all they have.
Yeah, I guess that just kind of struck me as funny. It's like you're miming, but you have 50 million guitar picks.
You know how they say a penny dropped off a building like that can really hurt somebody. Could a guitar pick hurt somebody if it falls off of this thing?
Or the 10,000 people that fell off?
I guess there are bigger problems.
It's raining. Men really takes a whole new meaning here. There's the walk.
There it is.
Boots.
A windmill thing with his arm, too.
Yeah.
Now, I know we're talking more about the video, which, you know, we need to not do so much, but there was a moment there where Bruce looked like he was laughing before he went to the mic to, you know, to do the backup vocal.
He's having such a great
time. And one just wonders, what's on the cutting room floor? What kind of footage? What were they goofing around doing?
Yeah,
it had to be a blast.
Yeah, to be in Kiss in the 80s with the whole vibe of the way rock and roll was, there must have been so many chicks and so much, you know, they didn't really drink or whatever, but...
Well, the Kiss Exposed video.
Yeah, I mean, come on. To be Bruce Kulick in 1987 in Kiss is probably a pretty fucking smiley gig to have, you know?
Totally. Well, shit. And he just speaks so reverently of it, and he's such a humble guy.
But I'll tell you something else, too. You mentioned that you weren't paying attention to the song. I mean, we pretty much all have our thoughts locked in about the song, and this is just the outro. And then, so you don't have to worry about missing the song in this, okay, because thankfully there is a video to give us something else to talk about, because the chorus is strong. We all like it. So there you go.
She playing air guitar right there?
That was one of the most awkward air guitars I've seen.
There's also a random jib shot for the first time with the camera way up high.
Yeah, they spent all that money.
Like, you better use it.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, you know, when you're with a hot chick and suddenly she does something stupid, you're like, don't do that.
Yeah.
Don't.
Gene woke up here for a second, too, and, like, did a couple little two-step things.
But
getting back to the chick, you know, they'll read fucking Cosmo, and it's like, you know, tricks to turn your man on.
Oh, no.
Lock in with the eye contact. It's like, nah, don't do that. Don't ever do that again. If you do that again, you're out.
No, just put your body by his.
Yeah.
Put your body on his, and that's all Cosmo should say.
Grind on the pizza guy behind you, but don't ever play air guitar in front of me again. The stomach punch sound effect. Yeah. Ooh.
But she was totally playing air guitar, but like a really bad, like, hi, look at me, I'm playing guitar. She looks like Martin Short.
Yeah, don't ever do that.
If she was strong enough to hold a cello and play it, that's closer to the motion she was making.
Yeah, Paul's vocal dynamics at the end, like you said, ooh.
It's always good when they add little spice like that to the song.
Yeah.
You know, it's just not the lyrics from the verse and the chorus, but just some little exclamations here
the
and
outro,
there.
Man.
I will go, since we're almost to the end, I don't see anything changing it. I would say every vocal element is perfect.
I agree.
In the song.
I said earlier before we started talking about this, is this song, the melody is so strong and the hook is so strong.
It is. It really
and
is.
And I'll say, I cannot believe it wasn't a bigger hit. For this time.
Sorry.
That's all right. I was finished.
Producer of the year, Andy Jones.
That's right.
No,
Eric Carr had a Led
Zeppelin shirt.
I was trying to tell during the video. Certain shots, it looked like almost a Toys in the Attic album cover shirt.
It's Zeppelin.
But it's Zeppelin, yeah.
Like
cool.
Presence maybe or something. Yeah. That was the bully.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
Now, I know you never missed that part of the video.
I love it. I love
That's
that
great. No, slapping his own ass.
I think Bruce is wearing a T-shirt that says BK on it as well, if you can see
that. Yeah. British Knights were big back then, right?
British Knights, good call. Yes, I think that's it, the shoe company.
Or is it Bruce Kulick?
It could be.
It could
it's
be.
Dual it purpose.
Yeah.
There you go.
And what's Gene with the eagle?
It's the Freedom of Rock Tour 30 years
like
earlier.
A Napoleon Dynamite shirt with the horses.
unicorn,
or like one, or like a wolf in front of a full moon.
Yeah, like
one of those
oil painting airbrush things.
I'm just
yeah.
happy he's got a leather jacket on. At least
these guys
cool.
are all again, vocals perfect, fashions
yes.
pretty perfect here.
Could be the best fashion that they've had in the 80s.
I would not argue with that.
They were starting to change around finally.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay.
There you go. The murderous chick ended up air guitaring in the front row. That was pretty much
her. That's why he wanted her. She was a challenge. He wanted to win her over.
Like, I thought there'd be like a final scene of her or something, but it was like, nope, they just fade out and just forget. And then the rooftop thing, like, I guess they all take the elevator back down and go get their cars and go fucking home.
Yeah.
There's
a lot of loose ends in the plot here. Whatever.
We're not judging the video, we're judging the song.
Yeah. You know, I don't need everything to be resolved in my plot.
Yeah.
So I'm good with it.
Yeah, I'm cool with it. They might have wanted to continue on the fourth single, but since Crazy Nights wasn't as big of a hit, they didn't have a fourth single. So.
What would have been the fourth single, in your opinion?
I couldn't have been a Gene. It would have to have been another Paul. So, I mean, you could have done My Way. You could have done Fight Hell to Hold You, maybe?
Fight Hell to Hold You probably would have worked.
But you know what it would have been, though? I bet you they would have went with Cheesy Bang Bang You. Because that's just the time frame.
Well,
you
know, I have
Cheesy.
I hold that one in high esteem.
You like it?
I love that one.
Okay, well, then there you go. So that probably would have been
the opening line. My love is like a cannonball. It, right there, it's like, you have me, you know.
See, for me, I love when your walls come down with Liar, Liar with your pants on fire. I know you want it. You know you want it, too. So, yeah, they could have picked any Paul song off that record, and it would have worked for me. So.
Yep.
Not.
Can you imagine a Kiss album with four singles and they're all Paul's? Gene would have been just furious.
What about No, No, No? That would have been the closest Gene pick, right?
Yeah, it's still not as good as the other Paul's.
No, but that would have been probably the one they would have won.
The obligatory Gene single.
Yeah.
So he didn't quit.
They didn't have one between Lick It Up and actually between Creatures of the Night and Revenge, there wasn't a Gene single or video.
That's crazy.
Not one.
Yeah.
The fact that Gene would stand for that.
Well, but that illustrates how checked out he was.
Good call.
You know, focusing on his movie career and
those two bookend albums, Creatures and Revenge, are such strong Gene albums.
Yeah,
I mean, he was an absolute monster on both of them.
And that's when he came back.
Yeah,
I'm sure Paul was so happy when he came back, but probably also a little bit like, shit.
Yeah,
parents are home.
Right.
So what happens now?
Now it's time for us to vote.
Okay.
First round of voting if it should go to a second round.
Okay.
But this would be the Hot Hell or Hallelujah stage. So why don't you go first? It's your
first. I think, you know, it's definitely a Hallelujah.
Do you want to tell us why?
Well, I mean, like I said, I mean, to me, when I first heard this song, I remember when I bought Crazy Nights in the store, it was like, it's a little bit too poppy for me. But the more I listened to it, it started to really stand out as just a great hooky track. And then I've loved it, like I said, for 29 years now. And it's a standout for me. And even talking to Paul about it specifically, why wasn't Turn on the Night a bigger hit? And he said that Kiss just didn't get radio support in the 80s because we were Kiss. And they always kind of demeaned us and looked down at us because we were the makeup band.
Right.
And he said it's the same reason why Reason to Live didn't go higher. Because if Reason to Live was done by Heart, it would have been a number one song.
Oh, yeah.
Totally.
Absolutely.
And I think it's the same with Turn on the Night as well. Just kind of, you know, underrated because it was a Kiss song, but in the Kiss pantheon, it's one of my favorites from that time frame.
Now, as far as just because you brought up something, you were saying if Heart had done Reason to Live. Now, what band would you think this one could have been a hit with?
Bon Jovi.
Just Bon Jovi. Yeah. You think so? Yeah.
That style. I think it was.
Yeah.
If Bon Jovi would have done this, it would have been a bigger hit. You know, it's got 80s pop metal written all over it. Like Chris was saying, it's pretty much a perfect song for what it's trying to be, in my opinion.
Who wants to vote next?
I'll go next. I will concur. This is one that I've always liked. I like My Way also.
Mm-hmm.
And since it bears such a strong resemblance musically, I enjoy both of them. I don't even know that I would put it, like, if you want to. You can almost say it's like there's guilty pleasure elements with the over the top synthesizer and everything like that. But I don't even know if it goes into that territory. like calling it a guilty pleasure.
I agree.
I think it's just a great, song, great hooky song, and the solo was great.
Yeah,
drums were great. Watching Eric Carr in the video was great because he's like sticking the tongue out. He's, you know, being the kind of the silly, entertaining guy that everybody says he was. So
yeah, once again, the only kind of guy that wasn't into it was Gene. You can see that in the video. At least he looked cool, but playing wise, I mean, Gene is an unbelievable bass player, as we all know.
Yeah, we've talked about that.
In the 80s, he didn't fucking even play anything Gene like. He was just like bum 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 bum.
Yeah, it's just like the root of the chord.
Whereas before he'd be like bum ding 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 bum bing, or something like that. None of that, which really bummed me out as a bass player myself, because you watch him play live now, he could be better now than he was ever. His bass playing is so sweet.
He
does it so effortless looking.
Yeah,
like if you really watch like on the Kiss Rocks Vegas DVD, just listening to what he's playing and watching him doing vocals over it.
Yeah,
it's pretty incredible, really. And watching him, it doesn't look like it's really
just what he does.
It looks like he's not thinking from the neck down. Like he's focused on the vocal. Obviously, you can kind of tell, but it doesn't look like he's paying any attention, but he's nailing it still.
I agree.
Well, and what you just spoke of, if you want to make a Kiss detractor's head cave in, say Gene Simmons' bass lines are very Paul McCartney-esque.
Absolutely.
They are, but so to someone who hates Kiss, comparing Kiss to the Beatles fucking gives him a coronary. So I do it as often as I possibly can.
as a guy who's
an accurate comparison.
As a guy who Beatles are my favorite band of all time, with Kiss being probably second, if not third, up there. You're damn right. It's the only band in history that is similar to the Beatles in so many ways. In the fact that you had four guys with distinct personalities, everyone knew all four of them sang, all four of them wrote, all four of them had distinctive sounds. So I mean, you're absolutely right about that, and it's obvious that Gene was a huge McCartney fan when he was a kid.
But it's just so fun to fuck with Kiss detractors. That alone.
Go to the Rolling Stone Museum and call out Jan Wenner and say that to him. He'll fucking try and punch you in the face.
Yeah, well,
stupid little face. Not your face, his face.
Well, okay, yeah. Who's next?
Yeah, who's Andy?
Sure.
Yeah.
That puts us over
it's
the top here.
Dangerous.
Yeah. Well, wait a minute. It's got to be unanimous to get to the next
level. But it is so far, so that means it's going. There's one more, so we're getting there. But yeah, absolutely, Hallelujah. How do you not love this song? Yeah. What's wrong with you if you don't like this song?
Right. Or as Andy likes to say,
what's not to like? One of the many catchphrases.
If you're driving down the highway in a convertible and it's sunny outside and this song came on, you'd turn it up.
Yeah.
It's that type of vibe.
This
is
the ideal
setting. This is one I turn up if it's a summer night and I got the windows down and I'm driving to do Pot of Thunder. You might hear this one going down.
In his basketball shorts.
In my basketball shorts.
Suddenly a tent forms in the basketball shorts.
Yes.
Okay, well, so, again, this is my very first time hearing the song. Can't deny that the presence of Mr. Jericho is skewed my vote a little bit, but I got to give it a hallelujah, of course. I think if we were doing this regular with just the three of us, I'd have the same vote, though, because I don't prejudge stuff. As anybody who's listened to this podcast knows, Crazy Nights, I actually think it's the low point of Kiss, but you know, I had some preconceptions about Unmasked. I hadn't heard anything except for Shandy. I love most of that album. Same thing here. Great pop song. You know, I hear Diane Warren's name mentioned. I hear the synthesizers come in at the beginning. That's a recipe for straight to hell normally.
Before you even hear it.
But, you know, the song is well written. And again, Paul Stanley, fucking awesome.
Right.
Perfect.
Even for just Paul alone on this, you have to give it a good review. Like, for just killing it on the vocals, knocks it out of the park. And you know, I was nervous as to what you would think because when
I shouldn't make you nervous at all.
No, but I mean, just from watching, from listening to the show, I know you're very honest, and I know what you don't like. And I was thinking, oh fuck! As soon as he hears that synthesizer at the very beginning, he might go, "I don't like this." But very fair, and you got into it, and that's cool.
Again, give props to Kulik, another just perfectly executed solo by him.
And going back to the "She's So European" episode, when those overwhelming pre-chorus keyboards came in.
It didn't
really, I don't remember it rubbing Chris the wrong way necessarily. So
I'd like to think I take everything objectively when it comes to this stuff, especially stuff I've never heard before.
Right.
You know, I'm not going to be, you know, I don't know how the other Kiss podcasters, you know, probably know every song inside and out. You know, I'm pretty honest about checked out a Kiss through the 80s.
Sure.
You know, loved the TNA videos, which is surprising that I never saw this because, you know, they were definitely on my radar in terms of, you know, their videos. But
you know what's funny to me is, you know, obviously now is, you know, 45 years old, but when this came out and I was 16, almost 17, if I would have heard it for the first time, I would have given it a hell. I did not like it the first time I heard it because it was really shiny pop.
87, you were probably more into metal, right?
I was Metallica and all that sort of stuff. But I also loved Kiss.
Yeah.
You know, I was, like I said, I bought Crazy Nights the first day. I loved the Beatles. So I liked the record, but that was one of the songs that I didn't like. And over time, it's really grown on me to where, like I said, it is a highlight. But had I heard it for the first time then, I probably wouldn't have liked it.
Yeah.
I would have said hell, you know, so. Great points, Chris.
So we
what happens now?
Now we go to the next round.
All right, Hammond! All right, Hammond! I got a question for you.
That question is Turn on the Night, a Stone Cold Kiss classic with 4 votes.
Yikes.
How do we do this when it's 4? I think we've done it before and I don't remember.
I don't remember.
Because it's usually good, good, and real good.
Just do 3 goods. Let's not overthink this thing.
So, 4 good, 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 real good? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, let's not intellectualize
this. Smarmy
this.
Voice of reason. Yeah, let's not overthink this.
That's going to be on my tombstone. The smarmy voice of reason. It's perfect. And so we put the votes in match game style. So you stick your card in the slot, so to speak. Your little sign lights up and it means your vote's in and we're ready to proceed.
We usually go clockwise, but
we could. Start here and we'll move around this.
Okay. All right, so we start with good Chris.
Yeah.
And with
smarmy
bad Chris.
Yeah. At the end.
Don't start with me, though, because I don't know what I want to do yet.
Really? Okay. Well, we don't proceed until your vote's in.
Yeah,
so,
I mean,
you know,
we've got time.
We can't start, period, until all 4 votes are in.
We
so.
Could go the other way. We could start with me and go counterclockwise.
It's all right. Take your time. It's not like you have anything else to do tonight.
Yeah, no kidding, right?
So, you know, you just hang out. We got the room till tomorrow.
So, let me ask you this. So tell me some of the Stone Cold Kiss classics that are in that aren't like Rock and Roll Night or Love Gun, something like that.
Move On from the solo album is one.
Yeah.
I elevated that to SKKK status simply because of I saw the effect it had on Andy.
Okay, so Move On.
Who Wants to Be Lonely?
Okay.
From this era.
Okay.
Oh boy.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of more.
That's all I need.
Oh,
more
80s
stuff.
Read My Body.
Read My Body made it.
And again, that's
okay.
Because
it was
the effect.
Chris Jericho's leaving the room right now.
Yeah, I can't give Read My Body that one. But
you would if you were in the room with Andy while he's listening to it. Because when you see his
being in the room,
his hips start thrusting around.
My vote is in. My vote is in.
Okay. Nick, are you in?
I'm in. Should we go start with me and go Connor?
I can go now.
Okay, if you want to go first, we'll come around.
I was overthinking it too much, but like I just said earlier,
never a
it's
good
a
idea.
Perfect song for what it's supposed to be. It's a great hooky song, and I'm saying good.
All right.
Okay. So.
Okay. Normally we don't start the voting that way.
Oh,
new
sorry.
Guy. you know, we say
new
the votes
guy.
Are in, and then Andy repeats
always,
the question.
Well, then you could always edit it out. Then.
No.
We don't do that.
We've never done that.
Okay.
Yeah. We don't conform to any
you
of the.
Give me a rule sheet before I got here. How
no,
the fuck
we don't
fair.
Do that either.
Jeez,
you just,
man.
You're pointing out things that we simply don't do on this program. I don't know why you got to do that.
All right, so the question again is, Turn on the Night, a Stone Cold Kiss classic.
Can I go now?
Yes, you can.
Okay, good.
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 Real good.
Yeah!
Putting it up there, of course.
Let's do it. If you're putting Read My Body up there.
Yeah!
It is a party, ladies and gentlemen.
Probably the most ridiculous part of this podcast is that we play that.
The Garnet Silk. Good, good, real good.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Well, we haven't rubbed it. We haven't rubber stamped it yet, but we will.
Speaking of which.
Well, I mean, Chris was saying something.
I was just saying, like you know, I was starting to overthink it, but for 80s Kiss, you can't get a better song than that as far as what we were supposed to be. So,
and you said if it Read My Body's in, this
yeah,
is definitely
that's what I was like. I could have gone either way with it because do I think it's a Stone Cold Kiss classic? But if you have Move On in there and you got Read My Body in there, it's better than both those songs.
Well, the one way we like to think of it, somebody made a playlist on Spotify of all of the Stone Cold Kiss classics.
Uh-huh.
Would you want to hear this in a playlist?
Absolutely.
So there you go. Yeah. Maybe that's the way.
Good
and
point.
The other, you raised the question, Read My Body and Move On. Why are they on the list? They are on the list because they make Andy very happy below the waist.
It was.
I got the sense that this song makes you happy. If it makes you happy, it makes me happy. I'm not going to shoot it. Plus, what I'm going to shoot it down next to a pro wrestler who fucking throw me through that
yeah, right. I'll have a
door.
I'll have a temper tantrum and run through the door.
Yeah. But no,
throw myself over the ledge.
There's a contagious effect that happens sometimes.
Well, and like you said, I mean, it pretty much what's not to like.
Yep.
Yeah, and it belongs, and at the end of the day, it's our fucking podcast. We'll put it on there if we want.
There you
and
go.
If anybody disagrees...
That's just the fucking way it is.
There you go.
Dude, you gotta hear the whole thing. It's fucking awesome.
I have to go watch that, and I have to go watch the Donahue Peter Criss, because I saw it probably 10 years ago. But... Good stuff, guys. It was good.
Well, hey, yeah. Thanks for coming.
This is incredible.
Are you going to get fired from your U.S. mail job? You've been here for about an hour.
I just took the bag of mail and threw it over the edge of the high rise, along with all the 10,000 people that fell in the turn of the night video.
Yeah, you know, that's just a small thing to worry about. It's a footnote to the massacre of a whole audience, right?
Yeah.
They're not going to worry about the bag of mail.
Well, some people get mad at it. They miss their flyers, you know, the weekly deals, coupon books, et cetera, et cetera. So whatever. I'd rather talk about Kiss than deliver the mail any day. It's boring.
Yeah. So well, good.
I'm glad I was able to be a part of this, guys. I'm a big fan of the show. Like I said, heard almost all the episodes, and I'm real honored to be invited on the show.
Well, I mean, it's crazy for you to say that. We appreciate it, but the honor is definitely ours to have a guy like you on here. And,
a D-list celebrity like
D-list you. D-list celebrity.
A guy that I remember watching on TV since, like, the late 90s. I mean.
Yeah. Well, and that's, and no offense, but, you know, these guys are way more into wrestling than I am. And I, frankly, know you most from the metal show.
Right,
appearances,
that's always fun
who would be the equivalent of Smarmy Chris of those three guys?
Probably Florentine.
Oh, good.
Yeah,
Florentine, I like that.
Yeah. You and Florentine would get along good.
I'd like to be compared to Florentine. He's my favorite guy.
Yeah, he's a good dude.
But, you know, these two guys can speak of how borderline surreal it probably is to have you in here on our stupid little podcast.
But, you know, this is one of those things I always say, like, music bonds people together. If you see somebody across the room with a Kiss shirt or a... You know, Lars and Brian Slagle met because Brian was wearing a Saxon shirt. And it's like, oh, you like Saxon? Well, so do I. Music bonds people from all walks of life, no matter who you are, whatever. And we're all Kiss fans. We're four Kiss fans in a room talking about our favorite band. That's a pretty cool thing to do. So there you go.
Well, it's been a joy having you. Thank you very much for coming on.
Ow! Thank you, guys.
Thanks.
It was a blast.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Andy Jones! Nick Jones!
And Chris Jericho.